are, ladies and gentlemen, the great day of the British exit. Now, even if the UK doesn't vote to leave the unelected dictatorial EU, it's the beginning of the end of global government as populations begin to discover that they never voted to enter these groups, and that even when nations vote to get out, the EU simply continues the political process by distracting everyone and claiming that they've still got to hold a few more votes to decide if this is what they really want to do, and that, oh, your big banks and companies already signed too many agreements to ever allow you to leave, and oh, sorry, we're going to have to take money out of your bank account if you try to go, and it really doesn't matter what you do because this is an economic agreement signed back in the 1950s, so it's out of your hands. That's the same thing we see over and over and over again with the Atlantic Treaty and the TPP and the NAU. All of these are written by the very same cabal of globalists directly out of Bilderberg to establish a private global corporate government. And I know that you, the listeners of the broadcast, fully and completely understand this. But we just continually restate the facts, hammering it. And we've gone the last 20 years from no one even knowing what the euro basically was when it was first being established to now most polls in Europe show 70%+ won out. Now, I've seen them engage in a lot of manipulation. There's a lot of evidence of election fraud going on over in the UK right now. Paul Watson's going to be joining us live to break all that down. But this is a very, very historic moment that we're seeing as global government is brought out of the shadows into the open. Now, let's continue here with looking at some of the other news we're going to be breaking down today. Obviously, huge Supreme Court announcements. The Supreme Court has ruled Obama blocked on immigration. More details on that coming up at the start of the next segment. They've upheld affirmative action. Warrantless breath has been upheld, but not blood draws for DUI. So that's going to be struck down across the country. The problem is, just like they struck down gun control 6 years ago with D.C. Heller to a great extent, still Chicago and D.C. are restricting the Second Amendment way past what they should be doing, obviously, with that ruling and common sense. Also, we're going to look at the other geopolitical news coming up in the next segment. We have a cinema gunman injuring 50 in Germany. So that's causing more and more of a copycat effect across the world. We'll see if that's going to turn out to be Islamic. Bomb threat causes downtown Miami courthouse evacuation. This is just all part of this terror economy and system we live in. We have Moscow building a spy satellite in Nicaragua. These are headlines from drudgereport.com. We have nuclear missiles along the NATO border. That's now being reported as Russia's response to NATO's buildup. We told you about this a couple years ago because it was actually in the Russian newspapers. I was called a fearmonger at the time for simply reading what they were saying. Meanwhile, speaking of laughing at us, top Clinton aide has come out and laughed at the public for daring to care that Clinton donors end up getting jobs in the government. And in this case, it's top Clinton aide mocks donors' appointment to a board. This is all part of his flaunting their corruption in our face. But the true threat to the species, even bigger than nuclear war with Russia, is genetic engineering. And the cover of Time magazine that we have linked up on InfoWars.com, it's dead center of DrudgeReport.com, is the gene machine. When you read about this, it's what we've been talking about for a long time. They are gene splicing randomly, but they're also going in and editing genes. But as genetic engineers have described it, that's like having a photo of a giraffe or a photo of a tiger or a photo of a human versus the actual tiger or the lion or the human. And so what they're doing is they're going in and manipulating one facet of it, but it causes genetic mutations down the line in every case that are unforeseen and uncontrollable. Just like radiation blasting through DNA genes causes random mutations, you know, in 50-pound tomatoes. Well, this will cause all sorts of issues, leukemias, you name it. And if you think drug-resistant TB is bad because of overuse of antibiotics, if we look at the world today, we see dramatic change happening all around us, and a lot of it's for good. But most of the change we see being directed by the ruling classes of the world are to restrict wealth from the public and to dumb the general population down to make them more easily manageable. Then we see the management itself of the controllers, and they're too busy fighting with each other for even more control to be worried about massive, over-the-top genetic engineering 90%+ of worldwide nuclear reactors leaking, according to the International Atomic Energy Agency. They're too busy walking red carpets and on power trips and partying with their mistresses to worry about the fact that Russia is moving medium-range nuclear missiles onto its border with Eastern Europe and openly saying that if Europe continues to move troops in against its border, it may be forced to use those weapons. While NATO, who originally started the offensive, states that if Russia engages any type of hacking of any NATO member state, that without even presenting evidence, they will use military force against Russia. I'm not here fear-mongering on air today just so people tune into the show. I'm here raising the alarm because I have three children, and I've studied history, and I've talked to basically thousands of experts, and they concur with my common sense analysis that the world is teetering on the edge of massive collapse, and not just militarily through massive confrontation, but through economics and so many other crises that are happening. We are sitting on top of multiple giant global debt bubbles. And because the central banks that are at the top of the pyramid of control have engineered these bubbles to consolidate and to establish planetary government and worldwide taxation on the ashes of the old world system that they're collapsing, they have a stake in keeping this bubble going and trying to ride this tiger, even at the risk of destroying their own parasitic structure that sits atop of the current global structure, which they built most of and control. But again, that old system gives the general public too much power, too much independence, so they are in the processes of removing it and dismantling it and bringing in a worldwide cashless society with the Internet of Things, with all human activity being tracked, with all human activity being chronicled so that it can be taxed, manipulated, and of course, micromanaged. Meanwhile, two articles that stand out today that are linked up on DrudgeReport.com and Infowars.com are the Daily Mirror out of the UK and a Time Magazine article. First from the Mirror, robots allowed to trade money and claim copyright on their work under radical new EU plans. And of course, we now learn that the EU plans are basically the TPP that has been kept secret from the public. And now the globalists can program the robots how they want, have them create articles and create music or whatever they want randomly at speeds so quick no one can even compete with them. And of course, they'll plagiarize. Of course, the robots will steal. But who's going to be able to argue with the robots? After all, they're independent. Nobody programmed them. Of course, they're not independent. And then they can go out and claim copyright on everything you've ever done or written or said. Disney has gone to the Supreme Court, as everyone knows, as well as McDonald's and others to the federal court, saying you can't even use the word Disney or McDonald's. They've even sued the McDonald royalty in Scotland, claiming they couldn't call their ancient pub at one of their castles where they serve beer and bangers and mash, McDonald's Inn. So, as Matt Drudge came here last year and warned everyone that they're coming after the free speech, this is just one more way they're doing it. And who is spearheading the robot replacement of humans in the EU system, saying EU's, quote, future is robots? The socialist Hollande, the guy that's opening the borders up, the guy that is absolutely devastating French society and French culture. They are bringing everyone to heel. They want to tear down the old system to build the new system. And Hollande, 3 years ago, when he was first getting into office, he openly said, this is our system. It will be the robots that help the EU expand. And that means they're going to take human taxpayer money and Europe's economy and force it all through a robot revolution, just as China is in a robot revolution arms race right now as well. It's like a giant global Manhattan Project. They're trying to keep it secret, but now they're having to admit a lot of it because the technocracy's rise is beginning to be uncloaked. They're going in to the part of the operational phase and now beginning to leave the beta testing phase in many aspects. So the uncloaking, the emergence of this cashless society, robot-controlled technocracy, the beast system, is now beginning to come into view. Just the edge of it. But something truly dehumanizing comes this way. And the robots out of the gates then will have all these special rights. In fact, they're even talking about humanizing robots and just like animal cruelty laws, having robot cruelty laws. And there'll be government boards and institutions and technocracies like bioethicist boards that decide what robot is sentient and what robot has rights, or abusing a robot will hurt their human companion. And so the robots will have rights by extension, because their robot companions will say that they believe they're a person, just like they believe they're a dog, or a man believes they're a woman, and so then they must be given the rights. And I told you this more than 10 years ago, reading their writings. Now, last week, I saw headlines about all these new movies and video games and TV shows coming out where robots have rights, and robots are the new future, and robots are our providers. They're building a future that doesn't need us, by design, out in the open. This has always been the plan. The technocracy was first envisioned in the 1850s. By the British royal family, funding the Wedgwoods, the Galtons, the Darwins, and others. And they are now actually building it. Now, that takes us to the next article. That one was from The Mirror. This is from Time Magazine. How the science of CRISPR can change your genes. And it goes on, behind the revolutionary new gene editing technology. Now, this has been around for more than a decade. Cold Springs Harbor, IBM are at the head of it, with a DARPA consortium and a whole other group of universities. Cold Springs Harbor is where the Eugenics Project was launched. It was the sister project of the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute that launched the whole Nazi program in Germany. You might want to look that up. The former head of the program, Dr. Watson, not Thomas Watson the Nazi, but another Watson, is the guy that just had to resign a few years ago. He's a Nobel Prize winner for basically saying black people aren't humans. Just remember that. One of the most exciting breakthroughs, the article says, in science is here. CRISPR is a new technology that can edit DNA with remarkable precision, and it has the potential to change human lives forever. They have the ability to tweak DNA. Scientists could theoretically remove genetic mutations that are responsible for incurable diseases such as cystic fibrosis, HIV, and even certain cancers. But they go on to admit that they're already editing animals, plants, and insects, bacteria, viruses, you name it. But the problem is, when you edit one gene, they don't understand how it connects to all the other genes, and it will unlock mutations. I've had top genetic engineers on. It's well known that that is what this is actually causing. Imagine, as I said earlier, just what the development of penicillin has done helping people, but then down the road creating tens of millions of deaths a year worldwide of drug-resistant bacteria. And just imagine what all this genetic engineering does on that front, but it gets worse. Then think about how the globalists put Trojan horse technologies into all the different software and into the different cell phones and into the, quote, smart technology. And, oh, they promise we're not going to use the smart meter to tax you, but then they end up doing it. This allows them to put the DNA of up to 100 or more humans into the DNA of a new creation they're making. And this gives the rise to all these, quote, designer babies where, oh, we're going to have four gay men have a baby by combining their genes because it's so much fun. And because they say they're gay, it's okay to create this new humanoid because you don't want to be homophobic. See, they use political correctness just as a covering or as a camouflage to push this whole thing. That's why they're getting us ready with the tranny bathrooms, and you can be a dog, or you can blind yourself with Drano, and the government's going to pay for it. That's why they're getting us ready for all this bizarreness, because they're about to roll out the true science fiction nightmare systems. So there's the Trojan horse aspect to this. There's the humans being replaced by this. There's the globalists saying they're going to merge with machines and become gods. There are all these different angles to this, and then you've got thousands of firms randomly splicing genetics, looking for all these different drugs and chemicals and pharmacological crops they're developing. It is beyond a science fiction movie. And the globalists are in a race with each other, different power structures, to find the holy grail of technologies and systems that they believe will cause the singularity breakthrough and advance whichever power group is able to obtain these systems first, be it silicon or genetic carbon-based, to bring them to the singularity level. And whoever finds that first singularity breakthrough will be basically ascendant to the level of a god. Now, that's what Ray Kurzweil and Google and all the top globalists are saying, not Alex Jones. And if you remember, when I first started telling people about this 20 years ago, it sounded crazy because I was just reading their writings, but no one else was really popularizing it. Now you see this in media, in popular culture, in movies, in entertainment, because the public is being prepared for this. And this is the preparation for the end of this creation as we know it, not just humanity. This is the ultimate total environmental threat. Already the carnage that has been created by the globalists and their activities is unprecedented. Now, when we come back, Paul Watson, David Knight, and others are going to be co-hosting today, different segments, and taking over. We'll break all this down and more. We'll also look at the sit-in to go after our guns at Congress that almost broke into a fist fight. We're also going to talk about a whole bunch of other key issues straight ahead today, the Brexit and more. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm Alex Jones. I'm about to hand the baton to some of my co-hosts here today, but I caught myself in that last segment really almost getting hysterical. But why wouldn't you get hysterical when you're dealing with the rise of machines and robots to replace you, with the elite saying they're building a world that isn't for people, with the elite saying they're building a system that is designed to dehumanize? That's basically the number one issue that humans should be worried about, is building an environment, building a planet that's designed for humans and for our future progeny. But we've been taught this death wish. We've been taught self-loathing. We've been taught to hate ourselves. We've been taught to think it's bad to be able to defend ourselves or have our own private property or raise our own children. We are brainwashed, guilt-ridden creatures who've been too successful at removing ourselves from the planet. We've built a system so artificial that it now threatens to envelop and destroy us. Our greatest triumph is our survivability and dominance of this planet. But now we're building a system that elites are going to use to finally dominate us, and they believe save the Earth and make themselves gods in the process. We know how this story ends, don't we? Only people that are spiritually blind don't see what they're building or what's unfolding. Now, I want to get to the whole British exit, the EU, and so much more with our experts in the UK. But first, we also have this clip coming up. Radical Islam shouts interrupt Dem House sit-in over gun control. A war of words erupted on the House floor in Washington on Wednesday as dozens of Democrats staged a sit-in to push for votes on gun control bills. And now here we sit on this Thursday, looking at the aftermath of it in the video from C-SPAN. You just have basically the Democrat walking off the stage with Louie Gohmert. And reportedly, they almost got in a fist fight, the media claims, but there's not footage of it that I've been able to see.
Radical Islam! Kill these poor people!
No fly, no gun! No fly, no gun! No fly, no gun! No fly, no gun! Stop terrorists from getting a gun! Why do you want to let terrorists buy a gun? Why do you want to protect terrorists from buying a gun?
Are you going to stop?
Why do you want to let terrorists from buying a gun?
Oh, yeah, my God.
Why do you want to let terrorists from buying a gun? Why are you protecting terrorists?
This distracts from the larger issue that, yes, it is about radical Islam, not about the American people. How have they turned this around and blamed law-abiding citizens for what some jihadi whose family was brought in from Afghanistan did? Islam is going into a jihad militaristic expansion phase right now, okay? And that's what we're facing. And the answer is arm ourselves against it, and arm ourselves with the First Amendment against it as well, and exercise our free speech. Because Islam and its leftist backers are trying to restrict free speech right now as well. So both are in great peril. Here's part of the article. A war of words erupted on the House floor in Washington on Wednesday as dozens of Democrats staged a sit-in to push for votes on gun control bills. Tensions flared when Republican Representative Louie Gohmert of Texas declared the debate, shouting, radical Islam. Now, they say he derailed the debate. It wasn't a debate. They were just taking over, doing their own sit-in. So he went in and shouted back at them. Oh, but that's horrible and evil. They did a sit-in and took over. But, you know, how dare him? He just responded saying it's radical Islam. Democrats chanted no bill, no break, holding pieces of paper with the names of victims of gun violence across the U.S. It goes on, the confrontation between the Democrats and Republicans nearly turned physical when Gohmert began yelling, radical Islam killed these people, ISIS killed these people, CBS News reported. Democrat Representative Brown of Florida started shouting back at the Republican. Lawmakers on both sides of the parties had to basically pull the two people apart because they feared that there would be blows. You can read the full article and see the videos up on Infowars.com. I'm going to hand the baton over to our great anchors right now. More of my reports coming up today, but bottom line, they're coming after all of our freedoms. It's time to wake up, realize this is happening, and kick the info war into high gear, or we're going to lose.
We are back. It's the Alex Jones Show live on this June 23rd edition. Alex will be popping back in with more special reports. I'm Paul Joseph Watson. I will be your host for the balance of the rest of the show. We've got Lauren Southern coming up at the top of the hour. She, of course, has been touring around the migrant camps in Europe. She went to Calais. She's in London now, I believe, and she appeared on a Sky News gun control debate with an individual, a leftist, who engaged in the most blatant actual sexism and misogyny you could ever believe. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about Brexit. Of course, it's voting day here in the United Kingdom. I'm going to get into my experience of voting and kind of coalesce that with reports about vote fraud. Now, 2 minutes ago on my Twitter account, which is at Prison Planet, it's the top post right now, you can go there and see a picture which is taken outside a polling station. Now, ignore the cultural enrichment on the right. But on the left-hand side, you will see a lady wearing some kind of campaign badge handing out leaflets outside a polling station as people go in to vote on Brexit, on Britain leaving the European Union. That is completely illegal. In fact, there are other people who went to vote who were wearing Vote Leave t-shirts. They weren't campaigning. They were just, you know, wearing their vote, you know, with pride. They weren't reaching out to other people. They weren't trying to convince other people. They were wearing t-shirts that said Vote Leave. They were ordered to get at least 100 yards away from the polling station. They weren't allowed in to vote until they took off, you know, that campaign apparel, as they would describe it. Here's a woman who is standing right outside the door of a polling station. This just went up on Twitter. She's openly campaigning. She's wearing a badge. She's handing out leaflets. Now, I don't know what side she's campaigning for. From the color of the badge, it looks like the Vote Remain camp, but that remains to be seen. But again, this is completely illegal. And this is not the first example of potential shenanigans that we've seen in this Brexit vote so far. Of course, the big issue, which has been completely derided and debunked by the Vote Remain people allegedly, is the fact that when you go into vote, when you go into cross off in the ballot box that you want to either remain or leave the European Union, the polling stations only provide pencils, no pens. So of course that makes it ridiculously easy to simply erase the vote and put it in the other box, completely open to vote fraud. Now there's people all over Twitter saying, oh my God, you know, did you bring your tinfoil hat as well? This is such a paranoid conspiracy theory. Well, listen, we've just had the Austrian election where the vote was basically stolen from the conservative populist. He was ahead significantly in the polls until they counted the postal votes, which again was suspiciously in numerous different areas, way over in the favor of the leftist candidate that he was running against. Bear in mind that we've got a European Union headed up by unelected bureaucrats who constantly disparage the mere fact that we get a democratic vote in referendums like this. Headed up by people who, when European citizens in France, in the Netherlands, in Ireland vote against the European Union, vote against its mandates, they simply ignore the vote. Or they then change the terms of what they're voting on and make them vote again until they get the result they want. And I'm going to read some quotes later from, you know, top EU bureaucrats expressing their complete contempt for the democratic will of the European people over and over again. So we can't put anything past these creatures. They've proven themselves in words and deeds to be not only undemocratic, but anti-democratic. So it's no surprise now that we're seeing claims of vote fraud impacting this EU referendum. So again, this became a big issue this morning, people complaining about the fact that they were only being provided with pencils when they went in to vote. Now, the Electoral Commission came out to try to dampen this down and said that you can bring your own pen. And there was a campaign on Twitter urging Vote Leave supporters to bring their own pens. That's precisely what I did when I went across the road earlier today to vote. But here's the problem. There are accounts now emerging of people saying that when they brought a pen to vote with, they were told by the electoral officers that this was not allowed. Despite the Electoral Commission itself coming out and saying, yes, you can bring your own pen. So I'm going to read from one such account right now. This is somebody who went in, again, to use a pen instead of a pencil because they were concerned about the fact that that cross in that box, there are only two boxes, could be erased and, you know, they could simply fill in the other box and swing the vote. Don't put it past these people to do this. I'll give you another example of why that, you know, is a potential factor in a moment. But this is somebody who, she basically went to vote and behind her while she was voting was an elderly lady. Quote, I passed her my pen and said, here, have this. She pointed to the pencil and said, oh, look, it's okay, there's a pencil. I pushed my biro into her hand and said, use this, it can't be rubbed out. This is within a polling booth, remember. At this point, one of the three electoral officers stood up and said loudly, oh no, you can't use a pen. So these people who are counting the votes in these polling booths, handing out the voting slips, advising people on how they vote, they don't even know the rules that have been given by the Electoral Commission. So obviously that's of concern when the main body that's supposed to be handling the vote is giving out these instructions saying that, yes, you can use a pen if you're concerned about vote fraud. The people actually counting the ballots, the people handing out the papers, the people telling people how they vote, they don't know the rules. They're saying people can't use pens. And that's of concern. Again, there's an old Joe Starling quote. It's falsely attributed to him. But, you know, it still rings true, which is something like, it's not the people who vote. It's the people who count the votes. Now, these people are biased. These people work for a body that's affiliated with the government. They're dependent on the government for their careers. You know, they're more inclined to be biased towards the status quo, which is the Vote Remain campaign. Now, when I went in to vote with a pen, I took my own pen, the electoral officers were in there whining about Vote Leave supporters. Bearing in mind, these are supposed to be completely impartial people who are just there to oversee the process to make sure that everybody gets a fair vote. They were whining about Vote Leave supporters, quote, scaremongering about vote fraud. So immediately you see that there's a bias there, and I would guess that this is a similar scenario across most of the country, that the people counting the votes are incredibly biased towards Vote Remain. And incredibly biased against people who are voting to leave the European Union. And that snapshot just told me everything I needed to know in an instant. Now, I'm not saying that they're all going to miscount the votes. Of course, the vast majority of them will just do their job. Of course, back in 2014, we saw suspicious videos out of Scotland during their independence vote, where they would take votes that were marked, yes, we want to leave the United Kingdom, become an independent country, and put them in the no pile. Again, 83,000 people signed a petition after the Scottish independence vote demanding a recount. So we're already beginning to see signs of shenanigans. There are many people who have said, you know, if it's going to be Vote Leave, the establishment simply won't let that happen. Now, of course, there's a danger of appearing whiny And, you know, just because you lost, you're claiming there's vote fraud, et cetera, et cetera. But these reports are starting to trickle out. And in fact, we've got a video which we're going to play, which was posted on Facebook just about an hour and a half ago. I shared it on Facebook. And again, it's a woman who brought a pen to the ballot box so she could vote without risk of that vote being erased and changed if she used a pencil. And she then offered the pen to other voters. She didn't ask how they were going to vote. She wasn't campaigning for anything. She simply offered a pen. The electoral office in that instance called the police and they came and took her name. So we got this video. Here's the clip.
Just been having a chat to one of the males here.
Yes.
Who seems to believe that you're sort of...
I'm lending a pen.
Pens.
I'm lending a pen.
Okay.
To people who want it because they are worried about pens.
Right, okay.
I have not asked these ladies. I have never told them or asked them which way they're voting.
Right.
I have shown no interest in which way they're voting. All I have done is said, there are only pencils in there. If you haven't got a pen, would you like to borrow mine?
Okay.
Not where to put the glass, nothing.
I can certainly confirm that.
And thank you very, very much. And I still don't know how these ladies voted. Right?
That's not none of your business anyway.
No, exactly. But I was asked to come here and hold dogs today and offer people the use of a pen because there are only pencils in the polling station.
Right.
That's my job for today.
For all polling stations throughout.
Yes. But people forget that you are allowed to bring your own pen and sign it and you are allowed to use a pen.
Yes, so if they want to bring their own pens, then that's fine.
And if they want to borrow mine, they're 100% welcome. And if they want to borrow mine, they are 100% welcome.
That's fine.
Okay, thank you very much. Jacqueline, Linda, Jackson.
So there's the video posted on Facebook of this woman who goes to a polling station, uses a pen, God forbid, to make sure that her vote isn't altered, offers to lend the pen to other voters without asking them how they were going to vote. And the police were called. And obviously you saw in the clip there, the policewoman was agreeing that what she did was not a crime, it was not an offence of any nature, yet she's still taking down her name. Why are they calling out police to polling stations over people using pens? That's incredibly concerning, given the narrative that we had this morning. In fact, in the UK, it was trending on Twitter, you know, use a pen. That was one of the hashtags that was started to trend on Twitter, because the Vote Leave crowd were really concerned about this. And rightfully so, we've seen vote fraud before. It's not completely out of the equation. Now, I'm not saying that this is going to significantly swing any kind of vote nationwide, but it's of concern. And to simply throw out terms like tinfoil hat and conspiracy theorist, because people want to use pens to make sure that their vote isn't altered or amended, I mean, that's a completely reasonable expectation. And it's completely unreasonable to call out the police on people for simply offering a pen to other people. Again, they were not campaigning at all. And we got people within the voting booths themselves, electoral officers saying, you can't use a pen. Completely contradictory to the Electoral Commission, which came out this morning and said, yes, you can use a pen, you can use a marker, you can use whatever you like. Then we got photos of people outside polling stations campaigning. Obviously campaigning, wearing a badge, handing out leaflets. That's completely illegal. But the police in this picture are not doing anything to stop this woman from campaigning. There's one police officer in the picture. He's got his back turned to her. So she's obviously not being stopped from campaigning at a polling station, despite the fact that it's a criminal offence. So I'm going to track Twitter over the next few hours to try and find more examples of this, if there are any, because several have begun to trickle out where the electoral officers, who again, as I said, I heard them having a conversation about how terrible Vote Leave people were for, quote, scaremongering about vote fraud. Now, these are supposed to be impartial people who are counting the vote. The fact that they're having conversations saying how terrible people are who want to get out of the European Union, that is very concerning to me, because if it's happening in one location, it must be happening in other locations. So again, we're going to continue to track this on Twitter. And how will the vote pan out? Well, obviously, you've seen what's happened with the stock market. You've seen sterling go through the roof because in the last 3, 4, 5 days, the Remain campaign has reversed the momentum. As of just over a week ago, the Vote Leave campaign had the momentum. Almost every single poll showed them in the lead. Then we had this mysterious murder of Labour MP Joe Cox, again, a vehement pro-Remain supporter, by this mentally ill person who just so conveniently decided to carry out this act of terrorism a few days before the vote. And well, what do you know? The polls immediately swung the other way. Now, am I suggesting that this is some kind of Reichstag event? Well, there's no actual evidence for that, but the way they exploited it was absolutely shameful. And in fact, yesterday, they had a Joe Cox memorial event at Trafalgar Square, which featured all these, you know, virtue signaling celebrities, Bono, Malala, they had them all wheeled up there. And again, this wasn't a memorial. This wasn't a memory of Joe Cox. It was a campaign event. Literally before she's even buried, exploiting her death for political grist. And they had the nerve to complain about a Vote Leave banner that was attached to a plane flying nearby, not even over the ceremony. Bearing in mind this is central London. They're going to fly over central London, whatever is happening on the ground. They had the temerity to claim that that was Vote Leave hijacking Joe Cox's memorial event, which is only going to be attended by Vote Remain supporters anyway, so it makes no sense whatsoever. They claimed it was them hijacking the event to make political grist out of this. Again, complete BS, complete lies. This ceremony, this memorial service, was a campaign event for Vote Leave. The people there had Vote Remain t-shirts on. They were handing out information. They had signs. Again, dancing on her grave before she's even buried. They've done that ever since the murder. The newspapers, before she was even announced dead, blaming this on pro-Brexit people, blaming it on Conservatives, blaming it on anyone who wants to get out of this unelected bureaucratic tyranny that is the European Union. So for them to claim that the, you know, Brexit supporters are shameful and obscene and insulting for flying this banner over central London, complete unadulterated hypocrisy. But we've got a fantastic new advocate for the Vote Remain campaign who came out yesterday, and that's Anjem Chowdhury, the radical Islamic preacher who supports ISIS and stoning homosexuals to death. He came out in support of Vote Remain. Here's an article out of The Telegraph. Anjem Chowdhury backs Remain campaign as EU protects against deportations. Anjem Chowdhury, the radical cleric, has revealed he is backing the Remain campaign because the EU protects citizens against unfair deportations. So in other words, the EU protects his terrorist buddies from getting deported under these bizarre human rights laws. And that's why he's backing Vote Remain. So that's an amazing ally to have. We'll be back with more on The Alex Jones Show, more on Brexit, more on the shooting in Germany. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Infowars.com. So again, we've got the massive Brexit vote going on in the United Kingdom as we return here live on The Alex Jones Show. We're going to play my video later, probably in the next hour, the truth about Brexit, because if there are still any undecided people out there, and we've got a lot of listeners in the UK, or just who haven't voted yet, there are still 4 hours to vote. Now, of course, the markets have reacted. The status quo has reacted with the expectation that people will vote to remain in the European Union. Again, we have the irony of people exercising their democratic vote to basically strip the United Kingdom of its democratic power, of its democratic foundation, by handing even more power. And you can bet your life that if this goes in the direction of Remain, they won't stop coming. The EU will only get more aggressive. There'll be more regulations. There'll be more laws that are passed completely over the heads of the United Kingdom people. There'll be more Euro judges ruling on cases, again, completely overriding the British justice system. And You know, that's completely undemocratic, but it's incredible the number of trendies who think that voting for the status quo is some kind of brave, progressive, virtuous act. That's the lie that they've been sold by this entire campaign, even though there's a huge left-wing case for leaving the European Union. You know, there are numerous prominent Labour politicians down the years who have made the same case. This is a huge lobbying organisation. It's crony capitalism. So why in the hell are supposed left-wingers all voting for it? Well, it's because they're seeing propaganda like this up on Facebook from Avaz. It's a picture of Nigel Farage next to a picture of David Beckham. And it says, choose love, vote remain. You know, that was me thinking about that, thinking that, you know, voting and democracy was about policies and principles, not arbitrary, nebulous emotions. Apparently not. Simply use the word love and that's enough. Just vote for us. We're all about love. Again, no substance whatsoever, but it's really seductive for people who don't think, for people who don't read. They don't take the time to do it because they're lazy. They're virtue signalers. They just want to look trendy amongst their peers and friends. It's absolutely shameful. It's intellectual cowardice. But we're going to see a lot of it with this Brexit vote, and it might well swing the vote for Vote Remain, because you've got a lot of impressionable, stupid young people out there who think they're committing some kind of brave, progressive act of saving liberalism by voting to stay in the European Union, despite the fact that it's a massive lobbying organization. It's crony capitalism on steroids. But in a final minute here, I want to draw your attention to InfoWarsStore.com, because we've got the Hillary for Prison t-shirt. You've seen people wearing it at Trump rallies across the country. It's in fact kind of become its own meme. It's taken on its own life. And, you know, we originated it. It's become a very successful, very adept tool at starting conversations with like-minded people. So get your Hillary for Prison shirt limited edition at 50% off for 1 week only, and get the next one for 75% off. So we've got huge savings here. Again, buy one for yourself and get a second at 75% off, or get one for a friend, family member, or coworker. Let everybody know that Hillary Clinton deserves to be in a prison cell, not in the White House. Again, this is a limited time offer while supplies last at InfoWarsStore.com. It pays for us to send more reporters out to challenge the mainstream media directly. And, you know, we've had huge success. And that's because of your support. Getting the products enables us to build the operation. And you've seen the results so far. So get the Hillary for Prison shirt at InfoWarsStore.com. We'll be back with more news and Lauren Southern after the break. Don't go away. We're back. It's the second hour of the Alex Jones Show on this live June 23rd edition. Now, I was talking about before the break, the Hillary for Prison t-shirts. Of course, if you enter your name into the newsletter, if you sign up for our newsletter at InfoWars.com, you can also get 75% off that t-shirt. So be sure to do that today. Again, it helps us grow the operation. It helps us challenge the mainstream media directly. Now, before we went on air today, we had this story out of Germany. German Wienheim cinema complex attacker shot dead. This is out of BBC News. A masked man who reportedly fired shots in a cinema complex in Western Germany has been shot dead by police, the state's interior minister has said. Peter Berth told the state of Hessen's parliament the police stormed the Kinopolis complex in Wienheim near Frankfurt after shots were reported. Now, initially, the first reports that we saw about this, we're talking about 40, 50 people injured, not dead. So thankfully, it later emerged that nobody had died. At least those are the last reports that I read. And only the gunman was shot. It now appears that he had some kind of fake gun, some kind of toy pistol. And he was there in the cinema. He initially took some hostages. But again, nobody died. In fact, it appears that the injuries, the only injuries sustained by the people in the cinema, were as a result of the tear gas used by the police. But again, how are they going to exploit this? Early reports, which I've seen, and again, this is not confirmed, suggest, surprise, surprise, they're going to blame this on the right wing. They're going to blame this on Pegida. Again, this huge movement that has arisen since Angela Merkel imported over 1 million Muslim migrants into Germany, and of course turned most of the German population against her. In fact, two-thirds of Germans want Merkel out at the next election. A lot of people say she shouldn't even run again because of what she's done to Germany. Again, the crime statistics. These migrants that she's brought in, responsible for double, at least double. And bearing in mind, that's with all the cover-ups as well that we don't even hear about. At least double the violent crimes in Germany committed by migrants compared to the normal German population. These are official German government statistics. This is why German security experts are warning Merkel that the middle class in Germany is becoming, quote, radicalized. So if you refuse to listen to what people are saying, if you deluge villages of 150 people with 700 migrants, then yes, you're going to make a lot of people angry. Are all of them going to act out violently? No. But if you've got people on the edge of society who are already prone to this, who are hopped up on psychotropic drugs, just like we saw with the Joe Cox murder, then yes, those policies are going to lead to people acting out. So it remains to be seen if they will try and spin this into a narrative of the dangerous Pegida right wing in Germany. But it looks like it could be that way from early indications. And of course, we had another massive terror attack that was being plotted in Germany just a couple of weeks ago in Dusseldorf, involving Syrian refugees planning to conduct a Paris-style massacre. It was in a few German newspapers. It barely got any media traction because, again, they don't want that narrative getting out. We had a report back in November, shortly after the Paris massacre. German government covered up terror attack at soccer stadium where they found explosives. There were police eyewitnesses. There were EMTs that said they saw the explosives. And of course, that story was buried. The stadium was evacuated, but they later claimed it was a false alarm. Again, because they didn't want that narrative getting out that Merkel has placed the security of her country under grave danger as a result of bringing in 1 million plus Muslim migrants. But if they can blame it on right-wingers, if they can blame it on Merkel's political opposition, then, of course, that kind of thing is to be welcomed. So we're going to see whether it turns out that this guy was, you know, just a mental patient, a workplace grudge or whatever. But again, early indications show that they could be about to blame this on the right wing in Germany, which is going to help Angela Merkel. Surprise, surprise. We'll be back on The Alex Jones Show Live with Lauren Southern. Don't go away. We are back on The Alex Jones Show, this June 23rd edition, live. Now, the American Mirror reports NBC producer calls would-be Trump assassin good guy with a gun. Now, we saw, again, last week, this crazed individual, this illegal alien from the United Kingdom, try to grab an officer's gun at a Trump event and assassinate Donald Trump. That story got virtually no traction whatsoever. Can you imagine if a Trump supporter had tried to grab a cop's gun at a Hillary Clinton event and had tried to assassinate Hillary Clinton? They would milk the bejesus out of that for weeks on end. Yet this was barely reported. And in fact, we've got left-wing news outlets, which I'll get onto here in a second, even expressing their surprise about the fact that this Trump assassination plot got so little attention. But the American Mirror reports, in an effort to make a smug attack on the conservative position that the best way to fight a bad guy with a gun is a good guy, an NBC producer tweeted that the failed assassin who tried to murder Donald Trump could be considered a good guy with a gun. Matt Maurer, an associate producer for NBC Universal since 2014, tweeted late Tuesday night that anyone who kills a Republican nominee is considered deserves the same praise as someone who tries to stop a mass killing. So again, he wrapped it up in this little joke. But there's this huge assassination fetish on the left when it comes to Donald Trump. Remember the guy who stormed the stage back, I believe it was in March, you know, while Trump was giving his address. They tackled him. He almost got on the stage. What happened in the aftermath? Was he denounced as a violent radical, as somebody who had tried the same thing at a Hillary Clinton event would have been? No, he was given a platform by CNN to regale us all about how his act was a, you know, a brave act of social justice confronting the the Nazi, the fascist Donald Trump. He wasn't denounced at all. He was mollycoddled. He was promoted. He was venerated by the same leftist media that, for example, venerated the Ferguson rioters immediately after they burned down that town. Time magazine, in defense of rioting. So again, it's no surprise that these people are emboldened because they're never castigated, they're never called out. And in relation to that, we've got this article out of bustle.com. Again, this is a left-wing publication. Headline, yes, that Donald Trump assassination attempt should have gotten more attention. It's kind of a bummer that the recent assassination attempt on Donald Trump hasn't been bigger news. On Saturday, a 20-year-old British man, Michael Sanford, tried to take a weapon from an officer at a Trump rally in Las Vegas with the goal of killing the presumptive Republican nominee, according to multiple reports. Trump said Wednesday on Fox Business he didn't hear of the attempt until he saw it on TV. And I'm guessing many Americans didn't hear of it. So again, this is a left-wing writer, and this is not the only one. There was also an article in The Independent expressing her surprise that this story didn't get as much attention. Now, I addressed this in a video that I put out a few days ago, Crazy Violent Left-Wing Extremists, which we're going to play in a second here. Again, exploring the complete hypocrisy between, for example, David Duke coming out and endorsing Donald Trump, Trump having to disavow it over and over again, yet complete silence when it comes to Omar Mateen, on the record, according to his friends, as having expressed support for Hillary Clinton. Was Hillary Clinton asked to disavow Omar Mateen? No. So here's that report, Crazy Violent Left-Wing Extremist. Let's go to the clip. You don't have the clip? Okay, well, we need to get that ready. So again, it goes to the heart of the hypocrisy. This guy planned the Trump assassination for a year. He went down there. He went to a gun range the day before. He planned to carry out this assassination. You can say it was botched. You can say it was never actually likely to happen, but he tried to pull it off. And this is after, again, 8+ months of people on Twitter every day tweeting, kill Donald Trump. This is Facebook pages that remain up for months saying, I want to effing kill Donald Trump. Meanwhile, use the word faggot on Facebook, you're banned for 30 days. This is the environment in which these people are being brainwashed. You know, top rappers at the Coachella Music Festival getting up and performing F Trump anthems that specifically within the lyrics of the song call for caving Trump's head in with a shovel. You know, I've got a chopper in the trunk for Donald Trump. That was another one. It was on YouTube for months. It wasn't even age restricted on YouTube. And now YouTube says that any negative comments about another person constitute harassment and cyberbullying, and your video is likely to be deleted. Meanwhile, you've got these punks rapping about how they want to physically kill Donald Trump. It's on there for months. It's not even age restricted. So again, amazing double standard. And do we have the guest now, or do we have the clip? So here's the clip. This is a video I made a couple of days ago. Again, analyzing this complete hypocrisy when it comes to violence on the left and violence on the right. Here's the clip. Okay, leftists, let's play your game. MP Joe Cox was murdered by a violent, crazy, anti-EU right-wing extremist. That means all Conservatives and Brexit voters should be guilt-tripped into accepting responsibility for Joe Cox's death. That means voting to leave the EU would be disgracing Joe Cox's memory and siding with the murderer. So what about Michael Sanford, the British citizen who tried to assassinate Donald Trump? Is everyone who screamed about Donald Trump being a fascist, a Nazi, and literally Hitler, responsible for the assassination attempt? Are the 600,000 Brits who signed a petition to ban Trump from entering the UK to blame for radicalizing the would-be assassin? Are the innumerable left-wing pro-EU politicians who labeled Trump a threat to democracy culpable for the crime? Is it time to tone down the anti-Trump rhetoric? So what about Omar Mateen, the gay nightclub gunman? He was a registered Democrat and he supported Hillary Clinton. Does that make Hillary Clinton responsible for Omar Mateen's rampage? Does that mean Hillary Clinton should suspend her campaign out of respect for the Orlando victims? Does that mean Hillary Clinton should be repeatedly asked for the next 3 weeks if she disavows Omar Mateen?
Will you unequivocally condemn David Duke?
And second, how do you feel about the David Duke quasi-endorsement?
So what about James Wesley Howell, the man caught with guns and explosives on his way to a gay pride parade in LA? He was a Bernie Sanders supporter. Does that make Bernie Sanders responsible for Howell's plot? Does that mean Bernie Sanders should suspend his campaign in order to prevent other Bernie supporters from becoming radicalized? Does that mean Bernie Sanders should be repeatedly asked for the next 3 weeks if he disavows James Wesley Howell?
Why not disavow David Duke?
All right, I disavow, okay?
You see, leftists only want to play this game when they can change the rules on a whim. They lie, they cheat, they misdirect. After months of ignoring violent anti-Trump protesters, the regressive left is suddenly all concerned about violent right-wingers. Give me a break. You don't care about right-wing violence. In fact, you welcome it because you can use it as grief porn to callously push your political agenda. Meanwhile, crazy, hysterical, radicalized leftists continue to plot and carry out violence, safe in the assumption that the mainstream media will do everything in its power to twist the narrative and bury the truth. Okay, that's a video I put out on YouTube a couple of days ago. Go and check that out. But now we have our guest, and we got a few minutes here, but we'll get more into it after the break. Lauren Southern of The Rebel Media. Lauren, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me, Paul.
Okay, now, of course, we saw you at Bilderberg in Dresden there. You've been touring around Europe. Now you're in London, and you appeared on Sky News. I was watching the Brexit coverage earlier today on Sky News, and suddenly out of the blue, I didn't even know you were going to be on. You popped up there in a gun control debate with this erratic, angry old man, and it was just a one long exercise in ad hominems. Tell us what happened.
Yeah, that was an interesting appearance. I was actually quite nervous going on because this guy has written 29 books or something ridiculous like that. But we get on air and he just starts screeching at me, "Miss Southern, everything you're saying is fallacious. You're young, you're Canadian, you don't know what you're talking about. You're a libertarian, you're irrelevant." And I just kept saying, "That's not an argument. That's not an argument." And it was just hilarious to watch the Sky News host actually had to intervene and say, "You know you're on live TV, right?" To the lefty I was arguing about gun control with, because all he had was ad hominems. He had presented zero arguments, and he would not answer me when I asked him, how will any of these proposed amendments stop the shooting in San Bernardino, the shooting in Orlando? None of those proposed amendments that the Democrats are having a hissy fit in the House right now over would have stopped these shootings. It is pure virtue signaling. And this guy, he just had a mental breakdown on live TV because he had zero arguments.
And he was there engaging in actual misogyny. Now we go on about, you know, leftists crying misogyny over and over again on false grounds. This guy, about 10, 15 times emphasized, well, at one point he called you a high school student, but then he emphasized the word miss, over and over again. This is a supposed leftist trying to emphasize the fact that you're a woman, as if that somehow wins him the argument. What in the world did he think he was doing?
Well, yeah, it was strange because I can't imagine what the response would be from people if this had happened and I were a leftist woman and he were a right-wing man. Can you imagine if some NRA guy came on and was arguing with a lefty chick and was like, "Miss, you don't know what you're talking about. Miss, you're a high school student. Miss, you are too young. Miss, you are Canadian." Just so patronizing. And, you know, I don't typically call things sexist, so I wouldn't necessarily call it sexist, but you would certainly, if that were the other way around and he were the...
Exactly. We'll be back after the break with Lauren Southern. Don't go away. We'll be right back. We are back on the Alex Jones Show Live with me, your host, Paul Joseph Watson. Now, Lauren's debate with that gun grabber on Sky News was really a sight to see. You can go and check it out on her Twitter page. But I want to move on because we've got about 5 minutes left here. Lauren, you've been in Europe for a few weeks now. You've been to some of the migrant areas, some of the migrant camps. Last week, I saw you you visited Calais, which, of course, is where many of them are trying to sneak in the into the United Kingdom. From what you saw, how many of the migrants there were, you know, genuine refugees, and how many were economic migrants attempting to reach the UK to abuse the welfare system? Do we have Lauren? Okay. So basically, you can go and watch the video on her channel on the Rebel Media. She goes and asks these migrants who are at these camps, you know, where they're from, for a start. If you ask them where they're from, the vast majority were not Syrian refugees. In fact, I think she only found one out of asking dozens of them, one who was actually a Syrian refugee. And she shed light on another important factor, was that the media only shows the children, only shows the women in all these reports about, quote, refugees. She went to the migrant camp there in Calais, one of them, after it had been moved, and found basically three or four children throughout the entire camp. And those were the ones that were getting interviewed, that were getting the camera put on them by the mainstream media, while the vast, vast majority were, again, young, fighting-age males on their cell phones, the vast majority of them not from Syria, from places like Sudan, from places like Afghanistan. So again, the complete 180 opposite to what you see in the mainstream media. We've been lied to about this migrant crisis from the very beginning, and that continues to be the case. Let me know if we get Lauren back on the line, though. We're having some problems because, of course, she's on the road. She's doing reports, so it's difficult. Have we got Lauren back?
Hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Lauren, yeah, I just wanted to get your perception of what you saw at the Calais migrant camp. How many people were, you know, genuine refugees? How many were just economic migrants? Tell us what you saw.
Right. So we haven't released this video yet on the Rebel Media, but we've done a lot of interviews. Well, we did 160. And most of the people I spoke to were leaving for financial reasons. You are not a refugee anymore once you leave a war-torn country. You get to a safe spot, and then you want to leave that to another place. That is, you're shopping for the best place to live. That's not a refugee. A refugee gets out of the war-torn country and is happy to be out of the war-torn country. These people are shopping for the place they're trying to get the most money, welfare, and they're trying to get to London and Canada. That's what most of them told me. They have plans, and they didn't bring their families. They're all young men that are able to make this journey. They all have, they've all told me that this is for jobs. None of them, all of them were in kind of bad-ish situations. But, I mean, half the world is in a third world situation right now, right? You can't import the entire third world simply because violence is going on, simply because some people have a bad situation. First world countries, quite frankly, could not take that. And these aren't even families. These are young men.
Exactly. I mean, and we just don't see this on the news. A couple of minutes left, though. You also went to Molenbeek, because we were chased out of Molenbeek by the culturally enriched moderate Muslims there. You talked to people on the street. Tell us what you learned about the fine line between so-called moderate Islam and the pro-Sharia crowd in Molenbeek.
Right. This video hasn't come out either yet, but we did have a lot of people tell us, yeah, we want Sharia law in Molenbeek. We want this to be run by Sharia law. And you don't see that in the media. You don't see them showing that these Muslims are not moderate. Sharia law includes killing gays. Sharia law includes cutting women up, cutting people's hands off for stealing. And they would just shrug and say, I don't see a problem with that. Culture. I don't see a problem with that. And, you know, eventually they might already have enough people to sway Molenbeek to make their own laws. And they probably already enforced it themselves through peer intimidation tactics of each other in large groups. When I was there, I actually felt more fear being in Molenbeek than in Calais. There were little groups of men coming up to the saying to us, this is our property. You don't get to do it here. Put your camera away. They told us to just get out of there.
Exactly. I mean, that's what we experienced. I mean, Rob Dew got kicked out of the migrant camps there in Germany. But again, we got physically chased out of Molenbeek. The environment was a lot worse. Lauren, we're going to leave it there now. We're coming up against the break. But thanks for joining us. You can check out Lauren's work at The Rebel Media and Lauren Southern on Twitter. Go watch her debate with the gun grabber on Sky News earlier today. Fantastic rebuttal. She completely rattled and destroyed him because he could only resort to ad hominem. So go and watch that clip. But we'll be back live with the truth about Brexit next on The Alex Jones Show. Don't go away. We are back live on The Alex Jones Show on this Brexit EU referendum day. Going to get more into that in a moment, but I want to tell you about our Deep Cleanse special. Again, another amazing special available at InfoWarsLife.com. This is 20% off Deep Cleanse. We know that a clean, toxin-free body is the foundation of true health. That's why we developed Deep Cleanse, an all-in-one total body cleanser that doesn't cut any corners. This all-natural formula incorporates a chemical and toxic metal cleansing ability of organic zeolites in combination with powerful cleansing herbs. And you can see over 100 five-star reviews, again, all independent third-party reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Now is the time to stock up and get Deep Cleanse for 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. So go there, get the product, support the expansion of our media operation. Now, we got a story linked up on the Drudge Report as it relates to Brexit. Proposed EU army hidden from British voters until after Brexit. Well, imagine my shock. As citizens of the United Kingdom prepare to cast their votes in a nationwide referendum to decide whether or not to leave the European Union, a plan detailing the initial framework for the creation of a European Union army are being kept hidden from the public until the day after the vote. Well, what do you know? The global strategy on foreign and security policy, which envisions the formation of new European military and operational structures, was drafted by Federica Mogherini, High Representative of the European Union for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy. And the plan lays the framework for the creation of a European army, which is what the EU was intended to become all along. Remember, when it first started, it was just a free trade zone, just a harmless free trade zone to get rid of those trade tariffs. Now, it's an army. It's a Euro super corps. It's deciding 60% of our rules and regulations and laws. It's a federal behemoth. So they're waiting until the day after the vote to announce further integration. Remember, David Cameron went to the EU before all this, before he announced the referendum, to try and get some kind of deal to make it better, to bring back more powers into the United Kingdom. They basically gave him nothing. They did give him a vague promise that there would be no more political or military integration when it comes to the UK and the EU. Of course, they completely lied. We've also got the situation with Turkey, where in just a few days, the EU will again begin those negotiations with Turkey to make Turkey a member of the EU. What does that mean for the UK? Well, they polled people in Turkey and asked them if they would move to the UK if Turkey joined the EU, if they would move there, live there, work there. 12 million plus of them said yes. Now, we're already full. We don't need 12 million more Muslim migrants, thank you very much. We don't need more cultural enrichment. But again, that's something they've delayed until after the EU vote. So they're preparing all these goodies for us. They hid them from the public beforehand because that they know that would sway more of the vote towards leave. So they've hidden this, and they're preparing more of these in the next few days and weeks after this vote takes place. But on the subject of Brexit, I put together this YouTube video. I think it's got about 400,000 views by this point. The truth about Brexit, why it matters, why it still matters with 3.5 hours left for you to vote if you're listening. And, you know, even if the vote goes against us, which people expect it to do because people are afraid of changing the status quo, why it matters that we continue the fight for independence, for sovereignty, for the United Kingdom. So here is the truth about Brexit. This is the most important vote you will ever cast in your lifetime. So listen up. They're lying to you about Brexit. All this Chicken Little, the sky is falling. There'll be World War III if Britain leaves the EU. There'll be economic catastrophe. It's all total bollocks. The EU isn't planning to become a federal superstate accountable only to the bureaucrats who profit from it. It already is one. It already has a central bank, a president, a currency, a criminal justice system, a passport, a flag, an anthem. These are all defining characteristics of a nation state. They lecture us all day about nationalism being evil while trying to build a contrived pan-European nationality. Because it's not about free trade, it's not about peace. It's about obliterating the nation state and replacing it with their own Byzantine United States of Europe and seizing raw power. They lied to us from the start. They claimed it was just going to be a free trade zone. It's already a sprawling empire. And isn't it an amazing coincidence that all the economic, academic, NGO and arts organizations who are fear-mongering about Britain leaving the EU are being bankrolled by the EU? The EU pays organizations to call for the EU to be given more power. The EU then seizes more power, claiming it did so in response to popular demand. These are the same groups you now see all over the news claiming that Brexit will lead to the apocalypse. They're lying to you because they don't want their slush fund to come to an end. There's all this fear-mongering about massive job losses. The only job losses are going to be MEPs falling off the Brussels gravy train. The £3,500 a month general expenses, the business class refunds for budget flights, the €12,000 a month staff budget, the private shopping malls that aren't even open to the peasant public. And these MEPs don't even have to submit receipts. It's all a massive bribe to buy their obedience. EU officials pay a flat tax of just 21%. They're making decisions that have fiscal consequences for ordinary people, while themselves being exempt from those consequences. Power without responsibility, the ultimate form of authoritarianism. You've heard it said that the EU is undemocratic. It's not undemocratic, it's anti-democratic. Look at how the European Union responds when citizens in Europe vote to reject its mandates. In Denmark, Ireland, France, the Netherlands, Greece, the people voted to reject the Maastricht Treaty, to reject the Nice Treaty, to reject the EU Constitution, to reject the Lisbon Treaty, to reject the euro bailout. And every time the EU either made them vote again to get the result they wanted, or simply ignored the vote altogether. Listen to what Jean-Luc Dehaene, the former Belgian Prime Minister, said about a referendum on the EU Constitution. If the answer is no, the vote will probably have to be done again, because it absolutely has to be a yes. Listen to what Jean-Claude Juncker, the current president of the EU Commission, said about the French referendum on the EU Constitution. If it's a yes, we will say on we go. And if it's a no, we will say we continue. This is the same guy who said, quote, when it becomes serious, we have to lie. These people have nothing but contempt for your democratic rights. Look at the Eurozone bailouts. Under Article 125 of the EU's treaty, the bailouts were completely illegal. Under the EU's own rules, they were illegal. When Papandreou called for a referendum on the Greek bailout, he was turfed out and replaced with a Eurocrat. The same thing happened to Berlusconi when he said that the euro had made Italians poorer. He survived a million scandals, but as soon as he defied the EU, he was gone. This is how they treat leaders who, God forbid, value the democratic rights of their own people. Juncker spelled it out when he said, quote, there can be no democratic choice against the European treaties. If the EU were a country applying to join itself, it would be rejected on the grounds of being insufficiently democratic. Look at the EU Commission. It's the EU's government as well as its legislative body. There's no separation whatsoever. Imagine the Obama White House writing a law to ban all guns and then passing it with virtually no input from Congress. That's practically how the EU operates. That's not a democratic institution. That's a tyranny. Why would we want to be part of an institution that's inherently anti-democratic? An institution that seeks to regulate and control every aspect of human behavior. A complete insult to British common law, which holds that freedoms that are not explicitly prohibited are implicitly allowed. An institution whose Euro judges have declared that their decisions take precedence over national constitutions and parliaments. Do you want to live in a democracy or a technocracy? Do you want to have the power to remove the people that govern you, or be at the whim of bureaucrats who you didn't even elect, being ruled by people whose names you don't even know?
Do you recognize this man?
No.
No.
Do you recognize that man?
No.
I challenge you to name almost any of them.
We sacrificed our democracy, our sovereignty, in return for promises of peace and prosperity. And this is what we got in return. MEPs who we don't even vote for. They're completely ceremonial. They have no power. The EU Parliament can't even propose or repeal laws. It's all done by unelected commissioners who scheme behind the scenes with lobbyists.
Parliamentary democracy, once every 5 years, you can throw everything out of the window and start again. With this, once something is European law, there is nothing through a democratic process the voter can do to change it.
The people whom we elect to go to Brussels have almost no power at all. They do what they're told.
Got even less power than the House of Lords, for goodness sake.
Our votes for these people are pointless. They are fundamentally pointless.
We need to talk about immigration because the polls show that this is the issue that's going to swing this vote. So if you're enjoying the cultural enrichment that millions of Muslim migrants are bringing to Europe, then how about 75 million more? The EU is being blackmailed by Turkey to speed up its acceptance into the European Union. If that happens, 75 million Turks could eventually have the right to live in the UK. We've already got record net immigration. We're full. 333,000 immigrants pouring into the UK every single year, more than half of whom are from other EU countries. Double the number from EU countries that they first claimed. Now 500,000 more migrants from the Middle East and North Africa who have entered Europe over the past year could make their way to Britain from 2020 under EU free movement rules. If we continue down this path of political integration, EU-mandated quotas could see us swamped with millions more Muslim migrants, just like Germany. We won't be in a position to say no. This is already putting an incredible strain on our public services and the NHS. We've got a chronic housing shortage. We've got record homelessness. And thanks to the EU's open border policy, southern European states simply waved millions of migrants through, knowing that they would head to the northern European welfare states and would become someone else's burden. Now Sweden and Germany are making their own people homeless to accommodate migrants who have nothing but contempt for our culture. People from an aggressive and regressive belief system who hate the West, even though we shower them with benefits. So unless you want parts of Britain to become Brussels-style radicalized Islamic ghettos, we need to take back control of our borders. Like any big government outfit, the EU also wants to import millions more people who will become dependent on big government. Why? Because they'll vote for more big government. Despite the official Leave campaign shying away from immigration, the polls show that this is the primary issue motivating voters. This is how we win, by putting immigration at the forefront where it deserves to be. The European Union is an economic basket case. Since 2010, every region in the world has experienced significant economic growth, except Europe. It's the sick man of the globe. The UK sends the EU £350 million a week, enough to build a new NHS hospital every single week. We get less than half of this back and have no control over how it's spent. Britain has paid more into the EU budget than she got back for 40 out of 41 years. We spent more than double on EU largesse than we saved from 5 years of austerity measures. Yet where are the mass protest movements on the left? It's no surprise how desperate the EU is for us to stay. We're propping up their entire failing system. As the disaster in Greece has shown, the EU is only economically as strong as its weakest member. Now countries like Albania and Serbia are about to join, so more of our money can be transferred over to them. This is just wealth confiscation on a continental scale. Look at how the EU's devastated the British fishing industry, banning fishermen from operating on their own doorstep. These fish markets used to bustle with 12,000 boxes of fish a day. Now look at it, 200 boxes a day. We pay the price while countries that maintained their independence from the EU, like Norway, prosper.
When Britain joined the common market, it lost control of its fishing grounds. When quotas were imposed, several other European countries lobbied the EU for Britain's fishing rights to be divided up between them. The British government was powerless to stop this.
The EU has just obliterated the English fishing industry altogether. The quota system they've got now is just... it's just mad.
Local fishermen were now banned from fishing in waters they'd fished successfully for centuries.
Oh, just beyond the pier over there. In fact, it might be there today, this great big Dutchman. Well, that Dutchman's got 25% of the whole quota of all of England. It's only 3 or 4 miles off the Tyne catching herring and mackerel. Local fleet can't catch herring and mackerel and it's right on the doorstep.
There is still a prospering North Atlantic fishing industry, but only in countries that have retained their independence.
Well, look at the Icelandics and the Faroes and the Norwegians. They sell millions of pounds worth of fish to us. And they're outside the common market. But you tell me a common market country that buys fish off us, but they send the fishing boats to the North Sea to catch our fish. And it's just madness.
The EU has been paying British fishermen to destroy their boats.
Inside the EU, Britain isn't even allowed to negotiate its own trade deals. It has to fall in line with the other 27 countries. But what's going to happen to British exports to the EU if we leave? The EU takes 55% of Swiss exports and 81% of Norwegian exports, both of which on in the EU. The EU isn't going to stop trading with us if we leave. They need us. We'd be their biggest export market. We'd also be free to sign trade deals with countries that are actually growing economically and not be bound by the EU ball and chain. But aren't we taking a huge leap into the unknown if we leave, claim the Remain camp fearmongers? Really? Well, look at Switzerland, the highest quality of life in the world, 5 times the exports of the UK, one of the lowest unemployment rates in the world, low taxes, few regulations, a GDP twice as high as Britain, the same for wages, direct democracy. The people decide when there's a referendum, not the politicians. Switzerland still trades with the EU, and it doesn't have to apply any of their endless regulations domestically. Whereas Britain has to apply 100% of them. I mean, what's not
okay,
to like?
We're going to continue with the truth about Brexit after the break. Again, on the point of regulations, even an iPhone, every iPhone sold in Europe has to have a volume limiter, which is set at the recommended EU level. That's how invasive they are into our daily lives. But we'll get more into it after the break. Also, an update on that woman who was campaigning outside a polling booth. We got an update on that coming up. This is the Alex Jones Show live, Infowars.com. Stay right there. We are back live on the Alex Jones Show on this Brexit voting day. Now, earlier, and we're going to get back into the truth about Brexit in a second, we had a report about a woman standing outside a polling station campaigning, handing out leaflets. It's now turned out that, yes, indeed, she was campaigning for Vote Remain, and she was campaigning in Tower Hamlets, which is one of these Islamic ghettos in which a lot of people who don't really know how to vote, probably wouldn't have been that inclined to vote, would have been very amenable to, you know, her advice. So she's standing out there telling these people, these poor Muslim people walking past, how to vote, handing out leaflets. Now, since checked it, it's not technically illegal, but you can flip it around. There are people with Vote Leave t-shirts who simply go in to vote. They're not campaigning. They're being told to get 100 yards away from the polling station. So again, complete double standard. There's another report. A polling station in London has been forced to remove the St. George's flag after a man on social media claimed it was a dog whistle for the Leave campaign and made the room look like an EDL rally. So you can't have Vote Leave t-shirts. You can't, God forbid, display the English flag. But you can literally stand outside a polling station with a badge on, handing out leaflets, telling people how to vote. And in fact, Breitbart London interviewed this woman and she told them directly, yes, I've convinced many people who weren't going to vote Remain. So you can't do that. You can't even wear a t-shirt saying Vote Leave. They'll tell you to get the hell out of there. but you can stand right in the doorway and hand out leaflets. Again, the amazing double standard of the Vote Remain campaign, the amazing hypocrisy and special privileges that they've been given. But we're going to return to the truth about Brexit here, finishing up with this video, and you can get this on YouTube. It's on my channel. Get it out to people. Here is the conclusion of the truth about Brexit.
What's not to like? Switzerland has flourished precisely because it's not in the EU. Why can't we follow their example? Look at Iceland, same story. Look at Guernsey. Its head of state is the Queen. It uses the pound. It has a parliamentary democracy. It has control over its own borders. It has a thriving economy, a high standard of living. Crime is virtually non-existent. Guernsey is not in the European Union. Why can't we follow their example? The EU is so fixated with regulating and controlling our every activity. They're now banning kettles, toasters, hairdryers, and light bulbs if they're not eco-friendly enough. Big corporations love the EU because they can afford to adopt its endless list of onerous regulations. This enables them to strangle their competition, the small and up-and-coming businesses whose growth is hindered by these regulations. Despite the fact that only 6% of their exports go to EU countries, small businesses in the UK have to comply with 100% of EU regulations. A salmon smoker in London had to pay thousands of pounds to comply with EU allergy regulations to say that his product contained fish. Gee, do you think the consumer would already know if they're buying salmon that it contains fish? Look at how the EU conspired with pharmaceutical companies to ban vitamin supplements. Only Big Pharma could afford to run all the safety tests, even though there was no safety issue in the first place. Independent herbalists couldn't afford those tests, and they went out of business. Look at how the EU and big corporations conspired to switch cars over to diesel fuel to corner the market. Oh, but it was all for a good cause, a 15% reduction in CO2, because they really care about us. What they didn't tell you was that compared to petrol, diesel emits 22 times more pollutants that penetrate our lungs, brains, and hearts. For a crony capitalist deal, the EU imposed regulations that actually killed untold numbers of people. The EU imposed regulations that actually killed untold numbers of people. Why would we want to remain part of an institution that's designed to screw over small businesses and the middle class? Why wouldn't we want to leave an institution that jacks up our cost of living by slapping regulations and tariffs on everything that we consume? The EU's anemic economic growth has left its member states at the mercy of mass uprisings and civil unrest. That's why far-right extremist parties are now soaring in popularity. People are getting more desperate. Mass riots are now becoming more commonplace as a result of the EU's disastrous economic policies. So in what way does staying in the EU make us any safer? The Vote Leave campaign is based on sound arguments, facts, logic, statistics. The Vote Remain campaign is based on fear-mongering and hyperbole. Cameron saying there's going to be a new world war if we leave, relying on people not knowing the difference between the EU and NATO. I mean, what an insult to your intelligence. Cameron saying that the leader of ISIS would support Brexit. I mean, what's next? Is Cameron going to claim that Satan himself is in favor of Britain leaving the EU? This is Project Fear. This proves that their arguments are baseless because all they can appeal to is irrational panic. They're relying on the tyranny of the status quo and people being psychologically averse to change. That's all they've got. They're so desperate. They're sending out instructions to voters, telling them how to tick the Remain box on the ballot. They're sending out referendum polling cards to non-British EU citizens who aren't supposed to be allowed to vote. Oh, but we need to remain in Europe to have an influence, they tell us. Really? Is that why since the late 80s, every time the UK voted against an EU legislative proposal, the UK lost the vote? 70 times. Is that what you call influence? A vote to leave is a vote for the people. It's a vote for small business. It's a vote for lower taxes. It's a vote for cheaper household bills. It's a vote for lower fuel costs. It's a vote for cheaper food prices. Once we escape the burden of the odious common agricultural policy, it's a vote to free ourselves of these shackles. It's a rejection of the obnoxious elites in Brussels getting fat off their thousands and thousands of pounds of taxpayer-funded expenses. It's a rejection of an institution so authoritarian that it has brazenly rejected the democratic will of the European people time and time again.
With general elections, it doesn't really matter who you vote for, Conservative or Labour, because you know that in 4 years' time, you can change your mind. This time you can't change your mind. This time is for keeps.
This referendum is the most important political act that has happened in my lifetime. This is about our future, our freedom, our democracy, our right to govern ourselves.
What really matters is that you should have the power to remove the people who govern you.
And the reason why the suffragettes went to all that trouble to get the vote was because they wanted to, they themselves, be treated as grown-ups and decide their own destiny.
How on earth does handing over more power and more money every single year to a failing, corrupt institution like the EU make Britain any stronger? In what universe is handing over control of our country to people who we didn't elect, who don't represent us, a good idea? To what problem is the EU a solution for your future, for your children's future, for the future of a free and prosperous Britain? On June 23rd, vote leave.
We're back live on the Alex Jones Show now. There was an interesting story, which I wrote about a few days ago, the apparent cover-up of a rape of a little girl in Idaho by Muslim migrants. The people there in that town got up in front of the city council, basically played hell with them, demanded answers. They were shut down at every term. We're going to get to a John Bowne report about that, which is up on Infowars.com here in a minute. So we're going to get to that. That article was wildly popular and people are demanding answers on it because they got up in front of the town council and they basically just called them racist for asking questions about it. So let me know when we got that report ready. But another article up on Infowars.com. This is Kit Daniels. Media agrees Hillary funded by anti-gay regime still calls it a conspiracy theory. Of course, we had the big Trump speech a couple of days ago where he, in this blistering speech, called out Hillary for, you know, 20% of her campaign being funded by the likes of Saudi Arabia, who execute homosexuals, who stone women to death, who don't allow women to drive, the supposed feminist Hillary Clinton. Well, now, despite admitting Hillary Clinton took money from Saudi Arabia and other anti-woman regimes while serving as the Secretary of State, the mainstream media still claims it's a conspiracy theory. In what's perhaps the most hypocritical article of the campaign, Slate's Jeremy Stahl confirmed the Clinton Foundation raked in millions from anti-gay monarchs and other third world dictators. But not only did he question whether it was a conflict of interest, Stahl also failed to acknowledge the hypocrisy of a Democratic candidate taking donations from countries that behead gays and stone women. This is a quote from the article. It's true that Bill and Hillary Clinton's foundation did take between $10 million and $25 million from Saudi Arabia and millions more from other regimes and political actors that oppressed the rights of women, gays, and religious minorities, Stahl wrote. Trump has demanded that the foundation return the money. Whether or not this was an actual conflict of interest when Clinton served as Secretary of State, it certainly contributes to a general sense that the Clintons are too enmeshed with too many wicked people to clean themselves. So we've still got that controversy rumbling on, and now even, you know, typically left-wingers are asking questions about it. Let's move on now, though, because we've got the Wall Street Journal reporting in a big article today, population of non-whites grows, white Americans no longer account for the majority in hundreds of counties across the U.S. This is by Jeanette Adamy out of the Wall Street Journal. White Americans no longer account for the majority in hundreds of counties across the U.S., a trend transforming America's social and political landscape as Latinos, Asians, and Blacks outpace white population growth, according to census figures out Thursday. In 370 counties across 36 states and the District of Columbia, non-Hispanic whites accounted for less than half of the population as of July 2015. That includes 31 additional counties since 2010, such as those encompassing Fort Worth and Austin in Texas, Charlotte, Savannah, and parts of suburban Atlanta and Sacramento, California. So again, big government likes people who vote for more big government. That's why they're encouraging this trend. That's why you've got the Obama administration now encouraging minorities to move into typically white areas so they can begin to overturn those voting majorities. They don't care about these people. It's all about politics. It's completely cynical. Now we've got Fox News reporting, anatomy of terror threat, files show hundreds of US plots, refugee connection. Newly obtained congressional data shows hundreds of terror plots have been stopped in the US since 9/11, mostly involving foreign-born suspects, including dozens of refugees. So you've had that, you know, that media narrative again after, even after Orlando. We saw the editing of the transcript of the shooter, Omar Mateen, to excise, to delete the fact that he praised Allah, that he dedicated the attack to ISIS. Again, we had this whole narrative, Islamic terror is not the threat, right-wingers with guns are the threat. But now this new report shows, it makes clear, this is a quote, that the United States not only lacks the ability to properly screen individuals prior to their arrival, but also that our nation has an unprecedented assimilation problem, said Senator Jeff Sessions. Among the 580 convicted, at least 380 in these terror plots were foreign-born. The top countries of origin were Pakistan, Lebanon, and Somalia, as well as the Palestinian territories. So again, after every single Islamic terror attack, we get this drumbeat of propaganda that Islam is not the problem, that radical jihadists are not the problem, that it's the American people who are the problem because they have weapons. Again, another report that completely debunks that narrative. Now, of course, on the subject of gun control, we had the Democratic sit-in yesterday. This is up on Infowars.com from Steve Watson, GOP rep. Dems are holding gun control sit-in to strip rights away. As Democrats occupy the House Wednesday and stage a sit-in to push for action on gun control legislation, critics lambasted them for their actions, with one GOP rep calling the action a disgrace. This is Rep. Mark Walker, quote, calling this sit-in is a disgrace to Woolworths, referring to the infamous civil rights protest sit-ins that took place in the 1960s. So he's lambasting them for conducting sit-ins that actually take rights away from people. Of course, the first gun control laws were against black people. Now, we also had Charlie Rangel, who consistently calls for the draft and all kinds of horrible proposals, saying that regular law-abiding citizens shouldn't need to carry a gun, but Democratic lawmakers deserve gun protection. This is out of Gateway Pundit, Dem lawmaker. Law-abiding citizens just shouldn't need a gun. Again, you don't get to protect yourself, but the elite do. So he came out with these comments again, proving that he's a complete hypocrite. But unlike others who refuse to even mention the fact that they're protected by armed Secret Service, by armed security, he just came out and brazenly said, yeah, we're better than you. We're the political class. We get to be protected. You don't. The common pleb scum. You can sit there like sitting ducks in your gun-free zones and be left completely defenseless. But many in the LGBT community are refusing to be left defenseless. This is another article out of Gateway Pundit. Hundreds turn out for LGBT firearms classes in Texas. Now, again, we had reports out of the New York Post last week. Firearms sales, I mean, they always surge after a major shooting, after the Democrats try to institute more gun control. But now it's amongst the LGBT community. And in fact, the video we played last week on the Alex Jones Show, where I actually reached out to the gay community and said that you've been abandoned by the left. They've chosen Islam over protecting your lives. That reached a lot of people. I mean, I got so many positive messages from people within that community thanking me and saying that they'd change their votes over to Trump. We saw mainstream media reports, we saw op-eds by people in the LGBT community saying that they too had made that choice. Well, now we've got armed classes, defense classes being run for the LGBT community specifically in relation to the aftermath of the tragedy in Orlando, and people are signing up for them in droves. This is out of Click to Houston. One look at this whole Phil Paper Target, and you can see Ryan Thomas is a great shot. He has had his concealed handgun license for 2 years. Thomas also happens to be gay. After Sunday's shooting, he had an idea. He wanted to make sure his LGBT brothers and sisters were protected. Thomas talked to his friends at the Shiloh Gun Range in Northwest Harris County, and now they're offering free firearms classes to the LGBT community. This is a quote from Jeff Sanford, the owner of the Shiloh Indoor Shooting Range. He said, quote, "We want to make them aware they can come here, they can feel safe here, they can get their concealed handgun license or their license to carry, and they can carry a gun, and they can feel good about it." So again, if one positive thing came out of the terrible tragedy in Orlando, was a lot of people within that LGBT community finally realizing that the regressive left has abandoned them. Again, in the oppression Olympics, they've placed the importance of not hurting Muslims' feelings over protecting the lives of gay people. And so many positive messages have poured in since I made that video. So a lot of people are getting the point. Of course, the LGBT establishment will never get it, will never change their tack, because they're intimately tied in with the Democratic establishment. But if you're talking about individuals in that community, Orlando has really changed a lot. And now they're arming themselves, they're protecting themselves, and that can only be a good thing. Third officer acquitted in Freddie Gray case. Marilyn Mosby goes 0-3. Police officer Caesar Goodson Jr. was acquitted in his second degree murder trial today in the latest trial against six police officers in the death of Freddie Gray. Baltimore State Attorney Marilyn Mosby charged six local police officers with murder and manslaughter in the death of serial criminal Freddie Gray on May the 1st, 2015. And again, three of these officers are black. And another one has been acquitted because of lack of evidence. Will we see riots on the streets of Baltimore just like we saw last year? Well, they've been threatened. Authorities are preparing for them, but thankfully, nothing so far. But again, another officer acquitted in the death of Freddie Gray. Again, another bellwether case that was hijacked by Black Lives Matter and by criminals, by thugs, by gangsters to riot on the streets, to burn down the homes of their black neighbors. For what? For absolutely no cause whatsoever. So we'll see if there's any more trouble on the streets of Baltimore. Thankfully, the last acquittal didn't prove to be the case, but we'll continue to watch that. After the break, we're going to get into this report. Shock report. Blacks commit 11 times more homicides than whites in America. Yes, it's more of those racist statistics that people point to try and stop this epidemic of black-on-black violence. How dare they? So we're going to get into that. We're going to get into John Bowne's report on the rape of a little girl in Idaho, the residents furious asking questions about that. And another report, another special report from Alex Jones himself. This is the Alex Jones Show Live, breaking news at Infowars.com. We are back on the Alex Jones Show Live, and before we hit some more news here, I want to draw your attention to the Tim Kennedy special at Infowarslife.com. This is 15% off Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12, so you can get 15% off all three products. As part of our partnership with Special Forces operator and UFC fighter Tim Kennedy, we're giving you 15% off on the top InfoWars Life formulas used by Tim Kennedy. Get 15% off on Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com right now for a limited time. These are the products, and you've seen him on the show talk about them, that Tim Kennedy uses in his Special Forces and UFC training that help him get to the next level. All three products have hundreds of five-star reviews and contain the known herbs that help boost the body naturally. Now is the time to stock up and get our top products for 15% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Visit InfoWarsLife.com and get on the Tim Kennedy InfoWars Life routine with Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12 at InfoWarsLife.com. And of course, we have InfoWarsStore.com, where you can get the Hillary for Prison t-shirts. Again, massive discounts on all those products. Vital that you fuel our coffers, that you fire our campaign to challenge the mainstream media to become the real media as trust in mainstream media declines, as the legacy media collapses. We're not funded by George Soros. We're not funded by a giant transnational pharmaceutical companies. We're funded by you and you only. So please get the products at InfoWarsLife.com and InfoWarsStore.com. Now, the Pope is talking about Muslim migration and how great it is once again. This is out of Breitbart. Accompanied by migrants, Pope Francis says a Christian lets everybody come. Oh, really? Even if some of the people that are coming, they're going to radical preachers who are telling them, let's destroy Christianity, let's take over Europe, let's outbreed Europeans. Are we going to let those people come? In a striking gesture, Pope Francis invited 14 African migrants to join him on the steps of St. Peter's Basilica, urging Europe to open its doors to more refugees. Because, you know, 1.4 million in Germany alone, that's just not enough. How many are we going to take? I mean, if you ask leftists in Germany, which we did, and some of the interviews are up on the Alex Jones channel, there's no limit. If you ask leftist politicians in the United Kingdom, like Jeremy Corbyn, there's no limit. There's no limit until they completely overturn the host population and feed on these people, because they know that eventually they will vote for big government. Big business loves it too, because they get cheap labor. Yet it's all dressed up in this humanitarian crap, as exemplified by the Pope over and over again. This is a guy who lives behind, you know, 39-foot walls, lecturing Donald Trump about building a wall. The 14 migrants were guests of Caritas of Florence and the European University and carried banners of the charity that is caring for them along with Vatican flags. On arriving in St. Peter's Square, Francis embraced them and then asked them to accompany him to his chair and remain near him during his weekly catharsis and greetings. Comparing the refugees, again, the vast majority are not refugees. They're not Syrian. They're young men on their cell phones who want to get on welfare. We've proven that. The vast majority, or the clear majority of welfare payments in these European welfare havens like Sweden, go to migrants. But the Pope compared them to modern lepers, stressing that Jesus would touch those who were excluded, but modern Christians seldom do. So again, it's all wrapped up in this humanitarian propaganda. The real solution, of course, is to create safe zones in Syria where actual refugees are coming from, not Pakistan, not Bangladesh. These countries aren't even at war. The proper solution is to create those safe zones in Syria. And yeah, you can have a global fundraising drive to create that. And it would be entirely possible. But no, they have to come into the West, even though they hold grossly intolerant beliefs that are incompatible with Western society, as we saw once again with Omar Mateen. This is already having devastating consequences for Europe. Again, villages in Germany, 150 people suddenly subsumed by 700 migrants hanging around the streets, vastly overrepresented in crime statistics. You saw what happened in Cologne. You saw what happened in Sweden at the music festival. This is bad news for, quote, you know, tolerant liberal ideals. And yet the Pope is dressing it up in tolerant liberal ideals to sell it. It's a complete and utter hoax. Yeah, unfortunately, a lot of people in Europe are still buying it. We'll be back in the next segment of the Alex Jones Show Live with a special report from Alex Jones. Don't go away. We are back live on the Alex Jones Show. There's a report about a stabbing outside a polling station as Brits vote on the EU referendum. At the moment, they're saying it's not connected to the vote, but we'll continue to watch that. Now, before we go to Alex's report, I want to tell you about the All Alexa Pure Water Filters, which are 20% off right now at InfoWarsStore.com. That's 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com for a limited time only, from the super high quality gravity fed Alexa Pure Pro water filtration systems to shower filters. Now is the time to stock up for the lowest prices. The Alexa Pure filtration system removes up to 99.999% of bacteria, disinfectants, volatile organic contaminants, and hormones. You could even built from lakes, rivers, streams, wells, and of course, municipal water. So again, you know, the government is stocking up on all this stuff. They're stocking up on food. Why shouldn't you? God forbid you might be called a tinfoil hat wearing conspiracy theorist for having something that cleans the water, you know, for buying many more of these great products, which have got independent five-star reviews at InfoWarsStore.com. And again, you've seen where the money has gone. You've seen what we plow it into, which is sending reporters out to things like the Trump events to document on camera the vile, violent behavior of leftist social justice warriors, to flip round that narrative that we saw the media tried to create right at the start of this, that Donald Trump, that Donald Trump supporters were responsible for the violence. We turned the camera around, put it on the people who were really responsible for the violence, and we flipped that narrative, and especially since San Jose. Now you see that the media can no longer make that claim. It's being completely debunked. That's where your money goes. That's why we cherish your support. That's why we want you to get the products at InfoWarsStore.com. But now we've got a special report from Alex Jones himself. Here's the clip.
So I started this talk a few minutes ago talking about what is a true awakening? What is true consciousness? And that's a complex question on the surface, but it's really simple when you look at it through a historical, cultural lens. Consciousness is our entire cultural genetic experience as a species, stretching back into the mist of time through our instincts and through our genetics up until this point. The great lie is that we are just these alone individuals. We are individuals, but we carry with us the hopes, the dreams, the passions, the sins, but also the great works and the love of those that came before us. We are them. And we have that love of those in the past and that electric connection to the present, focusing forward into the future. And when you don't have a sense of the space-time continuum, when you don't have a sense of the species and its journey and its mission, if you don't have a sense of believing in the species and believing in its survival and believing in its ascension, then you have cut yourself off from what it is to be human. And that's the big globalist virus, is to make you cynical, to make you hateful, to never let you go through rites of passage when you're young, to never go through cultural rituals that are meant to release chemical reactions in the brain that unlock race memories, consciousness memories that are far beyond the vague, limited statement of instincts, and that allow you as a current sentient being to commune and experience all of the genetic wealth and history and thought and dreams of those before you. This is only one small part of the spectrum that is the wonder, that is this world of fantastical magic that we live in. And that's why they want us to fight over petty issues. That's why they want us to be emotional and dumb us down into these, you know, areas where language has been reduced to the point where it's all just about color and spectrum and where you're from or what you say and what you do, instead of the real issues that are being discussed and debated. But here's the bottom line. The globalists have seized control of the planet. They openly claim it's theirs. They are the technocrats. They're the hardcore, cold-blooded scientists that have decided this belongs to them because the general public is so dumbed down and so mindless. But their great sin, as I have said countless times, is that they have built a modern system and designed it to make people pliable, to make people passive, to make people stupid, to make people unfeeling, undreaming creatures so that they can be managed. So how do you then turn back and look at the mass of humanity and say that they're a failed group who is deserving of extermination when you yourselves have set up a system to bring them down? And undoubtedly, everything that's been established in this great time of decadence is destroying the so-called elites themselves. They're not immune from the cultural and spiritual machinery that they've turned loose, that they've released. I mean, look at the oxymoronic paradigm of so-called liberals like the Democratic Party and the Republican leadership to a certain extent as well, bringing in millions of radical Islamics all over Europe and the United States, and then telling us we have to give up our freedoms so that we don't offend them so that we're not attacked, and that Americans are to blame for what happened in San Bernardino and Fort Hood and the Army Navy recruiting centers and, of course, Orlando and countless other events, Charlie Hebdo, the French theater, the 300,000 Christians killed by ISIS. All of this is the fault of the American gun owner when it's Hillary Clinton and her foundation and Obama and NATO and the French government and the Turkish government and others who've openly been funding with Saudi Arabia a global jihad. Saudi Arabia was only a few hundred square miles in 1901 in the middle of what Saudi Arabia today with a kidnapping bank robber mob of flesh merchants known as the House of Saud, a few hundred Bedouin robbers who then were given British intel and British money and turned loose to take over more than half of the Middle East, including Syria, by the 1930s. And now we sit here and look at them launching their tentacles and building hundreds of mosques per country every year and controlling the leftist media, who are a bunch of unprincipled sellouts. They already sold out to corporations. They already sold out to globalists. They already sold out to technocracies. They already sold out to communist Chinese. So why not just go ahead and sell out to the Wahhabists, who keep women as slaves and who are the most oppressive people on earth? And then we see Jakari Jackson, we'll play a clip of this, in Atlanta a few days ago. And he comes up and there's a black man wearing a rainbow flag talking in a classically stereotypical, effeminate voice. And I don't even dislike him because he does that. It's just that it's so standard and stereotypical. And he's bitching out some young black teenager man who's just simply there to support Donald Trump, saying, "You're a racist. Donald Trump wanted to send black people back to Africa." And Donald Trump's family's KKK, all of that, complete made-up bull, like saying that moon right up there is made of cheese. That's how stupid they think everyone is.
Why would you support a racist?
He's going
to send you back to Africa. That's what he said.
Oh, what
he said send Mexicans back to Mexico. You are a disgrace to America.
Thank you.
For being a young black man
Thank
supporting
you.
A racist.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's how utterly mindless and dumbed down they treat you when they sit there and they tell you these things. And I'll be quite honest. Do I trust Donald Trump completely? No. Do I think Donald Trump's perfect? No. But he's doing things that are irrevocably damaging to the globalist and world government. He's exposing political correctness. He's exposing one-sided trade deals. He's exposing it's wrong to disarm the American people and blame the American people for an Islamic attack. He's doing things that are incontrovertibly damaging to the New World Order. So I ask myself, is Donald Trump awake? I think Donald Trump is a emblematic benchmark, a gauge, a symbol, a bellwether, a weather vane, a marker, an indication that there is a massive push worldwide by 7.5 billion humans to go to the next level. And the technocrats of the UN and the big central banks admit they want to keep you poor. They want to keep you dumb. They want to keep you manageable, so that they can dole out culture and control and buy you and your mind and your intellect for pennies on the dollar. They want to block prosperity when it's prosperity that's going to clean up the environment, when it's advanced technologies that are going to raise us to the next level. They know that, and they're afraid of the new renaissance. They're afraid of those new minds out there turned loose and what they can do, because even maybe 10% of the world being somewhat free market gives people, with the choices, the products they buy, the food they eat, the culture they indulge in and promote, that spark of humans looking for freedom and looking for the next level is so powerful that any area that it's allowed to operate will automatically discredit the whole system that's corrupt and stagnant and oppressive. They can't, in this darkness, allow one little ray of light to come in, because it dispels their entire fraud. They want to rule like Bohemian Grove, like the gods that are owls, in the dark, where only they are illuminated because they can see in the black. Those that truly want to illuminate humanity want everyone to see and believe in humanity and believe in the animating contest that Thomas Jefferson talked about. Human consciousness, human free will, is so grand, so expansive, that I'm not even pretending here today, as the sun sets in Central Texas, to even give you a glimpse of the free will that you already know is within your heart and your soul. The free will, the free association that the creator of the universe gave us all. But all I'm saying is, don't let the establishment media emotionally program you to follow their paradigms. The right wing is incredibly corrupt and dumbed down. I spent years attacking Bush and the Republicans. But under Obama, even the head of the Green Party, even top liberal lawyers like Jonathan Turley and countless others have said that things are basically three times worse than they were under Bush. Not that Bush was a better guy. He wasn't as good a deceiver as Barack Obama, who could carry the globalist football even further. The truth is, technology and civilization is too advanced for the elite. They want to keep it for themselves. If they give it to the general public, who actually developed it, that will allow us to be on a level playing field, and they won't have a monopoly anymore. Over. Life Extension Technologies. They're openly on television, as I told you 20 years ago they would do, promoting microchips for all children, with the Pentagon and the Navy looking at microchipping sailors and soldiers and Marines. I'm not against technology, but the way the elite are deploying technology is, again, designed to shutter the consciousness. Drudge, 4 or 5 months ago, focused in on Zuckerberg of Facebook at a big corporate event, ordering his employees to wear virtual reality goggles over their heads and sit like apes, not evolved, in a little Plato cave, receiving the control paradigm he wanted to, as he, smiling, walked bipedal, a god amongst men. And what's scary is they know our subconscious is more powerful than our conscious hundreds of times. So they bombard us with sick, demoralizing images and messages, both unconsciously and consciously, both overtly and subliminally, to break our will at a subconscious level and make us think we're absolutely outnumbered and totally defeated, so that when someone who is conscious warns you, the magician has already programmed you to the point that you have automatic defenses to see nothing, to hear nothing, to say nothing, to feel nothing. And then you are a true slave. Because a man or woman who's in some supermax prison, who's falsely accused, falsely convicted, who still has will, is a free entity, is a free soul. But when you are so blasted by the lie, when you are so captured by the fraud, that it's heresy to even doubt the world you're in and even question what the mainstream system is saying, because then you're a conspiracy theorist heretic, you are past oblivion into a death cult. We know they lied to us about NSA spying and the ATF shipping guns into Mexico in Fast and Furious to frame the Second Amendment. We know they lied about secret testing on minorities and poor Appalachian whites. We know they lied to us about what glyphosate was doing on the water supply. They lied to us about fluoride causing brain damage and cancer. They lied to us about nuclear reactors leaking radiation. They lied to us about Obamacare being free. They lied to us about thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of things. And the great Nazi propagandist, great at evil, wrote, you can look it up, that good propaganda doesn't need to even be complex or have some edge of truth. It has to be a big, overt, giant lie. Hitler always gets the quote for this. It was actually Goebbels that said it. It's so big, it's so ridiculous, it's so over the top, like Obama saying, you didn't build your business, or 2 + 2 = 5, or, you know, you can keep your doctor. It's so over, or Americans shot up the gay bar. No, it was a freaking guy that hated America and was a foreigner in Seoul. It's so over the top that you just feel alone and have a normalcy bias like Stockholm syndrome, where you go, I'm all alone. This lie is ridiculous. Why is everyone going along with it? I better go along with it, because who does that say I am? And that's what we're getting down to here, is that it's all to make you feel small. And I'm not saying be on some power trip, But I'm saying reality, the universe, basic truth, nature around us, the stars at night, that's all trillions of times bigger than CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, Pentagon propaganda, the globalist. And we simply haven't decided that in our innate ancestral instincts and our spirit, everything God gave us, and our own life experiences, we're going to set out to discover what the truth is, and then we're going to reach out, not with all the truth, because none of us have all the answers, but with the bits we figured out with others, and that together we're going to put it together and come together and try to develop a cosmology that more closely matches the universe and that is based on truth, so that we have a better light in this forest at night to travel together on this great quest and the stairway to heaven that leads potentially to the stars. Because the Bible says the eye has not seen, the ear has not heard what our Creator has in store for us. And whether you believe in the Bible or not, it talks about we're master creators, we're made in the image of God, little God, that we're able to envision and build like the Creator. And look at things that were science fiction 100 years ago. We've manifest, we've done it, we've built it. But it isn't like Oprah Winfrey and The Secret, where you just believe it and it happens. It's built on generations and their dreams before us. It's built on scientific developments and technological developments, many of them spiritually inspired, and understandings that come together in beautiful ways to move us forward. We are thousands of times more advanced than what we were just 1,000 years ago.
Okay, and you can check out the rest of that amazing rant up on the Alex Jones YouTube channel. Going to come back there after the break. We've got one final update on that mass shooting or attempted mass shooting in Germany. Very interesting development. We'll be back for the final segment of the Alex Jones Show live, breaking news at Infowars.com. And I mentioned just before the break, we've got an update on that situation in Germany. Thankfully, according to the most recent reports, nobody is dead, but the suspect reportedly had a hand grenade and an explosives belt. At first, it appeared as if they were going to blame this on white nationalists, but now it's emerged, according to one eyewitness, that the alleged gunman spoke in broken German. So could it be one of Angela Merkel's migrants gone jihadist? Of course, we reported earlier in the show they've covered up these terror attacks before because it doesn't fit their narrative. Thankfully, no one died, but that's the latest, that it could be a migrant-inspired attack. So we'll be sure to keep up to date with that story. A couple of final news stories here in the last few minutes. We've got Breitbart reporting top lawyer ban referendums to save EU project. In the wake of potential Brexit, a top French lawyer has demanded that the European Union, quote, stop sacrificing the European project and ban referendums. That's right. How dare you even be given the opportunity to vote against the all-powerful USSR, I mean European Union, and even have a referendum in the first place. Laurent Cohen-Tanoughi called direct democracy, quote, populist suicide, and claimed that people's opinions in the internet era are invalid. So it's basically, if your opinion disagrees with mine, that's completely invalid. We're going to ban you from even having a referendum in the first place. How dare you even challenge us? Just think of the snobbery associated with that kind of comment, the elitism. And we've got another one from Jean-Claude Juncker, the president of the EU Commission, who likes to get drunk and slap people in the face in public. EU president slams part-time Europeans and national opinion, slowing ever closer union. Again, as I said, complete and utter contempt for the very fact that you question whether it's a good idea to be ruled by four presidents we don't even know the names of, by numerous unelected commissioners who make our laws, who make our regulations. We don't even elect them. The European Parliament, completely ceremonial, can't even vote down these laws. Jean-Claude Juncker, president of the EU's unelected executive arm, has complained that too many EU officials are listening to, quote, national opinion rather than pushing for an unwanted European superstate. Quote, in former times, all those implied in the project were full-time Europeans. Now we have too many part-time Europeans, he said, according to The Independent. Well, how about we don't have any Europeans? Because it's not about being European. It's not about culture. It's not about fine wine and food. It's nothing to do with that. This is about tyranny. This dictatorship. So I would rather be a full-time, you know, fully paid up advocate of parliamentary democracy than a, quote, part-time European or a full-time European. And this is what it comes down to. And this is why they're probably going to win, unfortunately, on the Remain side, because they've made it about, I mean, you've got James Corden giving a speech on TV. He's someone who moved to the United States. He doesn't even live in the European Union, talking about how the astronaut Tim Peake looked down on the globe and realized that we should all be interconnected. It's nothing whatsoever to do with that. This is about the freedom to elect the people to represent us, to actually have a stake in the future of our own country. It's not about the observations of an astronaut from high altitude. This is the BS they've wrapped it in. This is the amazingly, astoundingly dumb narrative that many of these young people have swallowed. And that is going to be the issue that swings the vote, unfortunately, unless, you know, a miracle happens at this point, but we remain hopeful. That is going to wrap up this edition of The Alex Jones Show. Breaking news at Infowars.com. David Knight coming up with the fourth hour. Keep it locked in.
Welcome back to The Alex Jones Show on this Thursday, June 23rd. Will it be Independence Day for Britain, or will it be a vote into obscurity? Of course, the polls are telling us are very evenly divided in Britain, but not in the United States, interestingly enough. There was a poll conducted. Forbes reported that 80% of Americans want Britain to leave the EU. I would be one of those. We would support that. We would say, try leaving the large organization. It worked out great for us when we left Britain. And, you know, the interesting thing in that poll was that former colonies like Canada, Australia, New Zealand, they also support it. But you look, all the rest of the countries, the European countries, all of them said no, interestingly enough. Even though there's a lot of talk about France and other countries, I think they understand that if Britain stays in, they're going to be able to keep this thing from unraveling. And that's the key reason we're seeing so much funny business that's going on in Britain. And I think we're going to talk about Brexit when we come back. But first, I want to talk about, you know, there was a lot of talk yesterday about the presidential campaign. There was a lot of talk about what Donald Trump did. I didn't see anywhere that anybody mentioned outside of the local newspaper in Raleigh, the News and Observer, talked about the fact that when Hillary Clinton went to North Carolina for her prepared speech, the candidate for governor, the Democrat candidate for governor, the Democrat candidate for Senate, the major Democrat candidates in the state did not go to the speech. Isn't that interesting? I find that very interesting, and I find it very interesting, of course, not anything new that the mainstream media would cover for that. We also have some Supreme Court decisions that came down today. Briefly in the news, we've got Obama's immigration plan was blocked by the Supreme Court. Of course, this was a 4-4 tie. What that will do is allow a lower court decision to stand. It will not establish a precedent in that case. And what was this about? Well, this was something that was led by 26 Republicans. 26 Republican-dominated states, I should say, pushing back against the idea that Obama is going to give special treatment and block the deportation of 4 million immigrants. These are people who came here as children. These are people who are the parents of the children that they wanted to come in here, okay? So he was going to protect all of these from being deported, and basically the lower court said, no, he doesn't have the authority to do that. He doesn't have the authority to overrule immigration law, does he? By executive order. So great. That's a good decision at the lower court. The Supreme Court couldn't make a decision 4-4. Couldn't decide whether or not the president can rule by executive fiat. Isn't that amazing? But that's going to let that lower court ruling stand. Another one that I found interesting, the high court strikes limits on, put some limits on drunk driving test laws. Now, they're saying that the police can still they can still penalize you for not doing a breath test, but they're saying that they need to have a search warrant if they're going to do a blood test, that you can refuse with a blood test. Now, it's not clear, based on this article that I read here from the AP, whether or not they're going to allow the drivers to have any say-so as to whether or not they're going to have a forced blood draw. Of course, that's what we have here in Texas, and some other states have started doing that. I would assume that they're not going to allow that. But of course, the penalties that we have in all 50 states, as the article points out, if you refuse any of these drunk driving tests, they will take your license. But there were 11 states that added additional criminal penalties over that. Isn't that amazing? They take the fundamental right to move in this country, and they turn it into a privilege that the government grants. And then they say, if you don't take these tests, if you don't give us your blood on demand, we're not only going to take away that privilege, which used to be a right to move around, but we're also going to add additional criminal penalties to you. I had somebody on Twitter tell me, you know, well, there's a fundamental difference between walking down the street and driving a car. And I said, yeah. Yeah, the fundamental difference is the way they treat you. But don't worry, they're going to make walking down the street a privilege pretty soon, too. They'll be forcing taking your blood when you're walking down the street as well. That's what these vampires are going to do. Stay with us. We're going to talk about Brexit, and we're going to talk about this ridiculous filibuster going on in the House. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Thursday, June 23rd, 2016. I'm David Knight. We were just talking about some Supreme Court decisions that came out. Of course, they had a ruling on whether or not there could be additional penalties against you if you refuse to take a drunk driving blood test. Now, of course, they're going to remove your license. They always say that because it's a privilege, not a right to travel in this country, they say. But, of course, this is going to affect rulings in states such as Minnesota, North Dakota. Here's the 11 states. Alaska, Florida, Indiana, Louisiana, Nebraska, Rhode Island, Tennessee, Vermont, and Virginia. Now, they didn't mention Texas in there. Because in Texas and some other states, I think it's in Louisiana, I think we heard some stories about forced blood draws. I mean, you know, really, seriously, strapping you down. Not only saying, well, we're going to take your license away, but we're not even going to wait for that. We're going to forcibly strap you to a gurney and draw blood out of you. And we've had situations we've reported on here where the people that they did that to were totally sober, totally sober. Are we going to allow ourselves to be treated that way? Evidently so. And evidently, even though they ruled against these additional penalties, there's nothing in here about forced blood draws. Now, they don't even mention Texas. So that's a pretty amazing thing here. But, of course, you know, we don't really have rights, do we? You know, as I said, I got people arguing with me on Twitter saying, well, you know, it's a different thing if you're walking down the road or if you're driving a car. Driving a car, you shouldn't have fundamental rights. That ought to be a privilege granted by the government. My dad drove a car when he was 8 years old. When he was responsible enough, by as judged by his father, who had a vested interest in not seeing his expensive car wrecked, he let him drive the car down the road. That was way back, okay? But the bottom line is, you know, they're doing the same thing now in Virginia. They're saying you can't drive a boat without a special license. Unless you are over a certain age, because I know people my age aren't going to stand up for that BS. We're not going to have you turn our rights into privileges. But look at this in Florida, okay? You think, wow, that's different. People are operating a dangerous motor vehicle, and we need to determine at a time whether they're okay. Look, let the insurance company adjudicate and have an independent person say, hey, this is a good driver or not a good driver. I mean, I'm okay with that. I'm not okay, actually, with them forcing you to buy insurance. I think you ought to be able to sue people. I don't have to have insurance to do most of the things I do in life, and I don't agree with insurance for cars either. You know, I'm kind of an anarchist, I guess, but I do believe that government is good for some things, not very many. And whatever they do, they don't seem to do it very well, do they? Look at this in Florida. You got an attorney says growing vegetables is not a fundamental right. Okay, not a fundamental right. This woman lived in Miami Shores for 17 years, growing vegetables in her front yard. Now, the city has decided, since 2014, they're going to assess her $50 a day. $50 a day for growing vegetables. Okay, so they've got a nonprofit organization that's taking up her case. And the attorney that they corresponded to for the city said, there certainly is not a fundamental right to grow vegetables in your front yard, he said. See, that's where we go. If we're going to throw away our liberty for safety, for the promise of safety, we're going to throw it away for the promise of security or for prosperity, we will become slaves. We won't be able to walk down the street without getting a forced blood draw either. So let's talk about what's going on with guns, okay? Let's go to something else. It's really dangerous, guns, when they're not used properly, all right? You got these House Democrats who are staging a sit-in to protest the fact there's no gun control votes. They don't like the democratic process. They also don't seem to understand that while the Senate has a process called a filibuster. They don't. They don't have a process called a filibuster. What they do is they have, and I love the way they put it in The Economist. They say, this is guerrilla theater performances in the chamber of the House of Representatives. They say, there's a couple of dozen normally buttoned-down members of Congress assuming awkwardly demure poses after dropping their suited and skirted rear ends to the carpeted floor and sitting there for 24 hours. So, you know, it's now over. I guess, you know, the filibuster, I guess they said, instead of it being a filibuster, I guess they said, I feel my butt hurt. And they stopped, okay? But they got their moment of guerrilla theater, and they put it out on social media. And, of course, we had that one incident where you had a representative from Texas, Louis Gohmert, got up and got very close in a yelling match. And people said, well, it looks like they came pretty close to coming to blows. They got other members from both sides to part them. They said earlier, these people shouted down Speaker Paul Ryan when he attempted to restore order as their protest stretched into the night. And here's the point. You know, they don't have a filibuster, as I said, but you wind up getting a sit-in because you have a chair, Paul Ryan, who doesn't work. When you don't have a chair, you wind up with a sit-in. So he tried to get control of it overnight. He tried to bring order. He couldn't do it. And they're in there shouting, chanting, we shall overcome, as if it's a civil rights meeting. Should somebody tell these people that if they want to approach civil rights, they don't take our fundamental God-given rights to protect ourselves that are guaranteed in the Constitution and try to overturn that? Instead, what they ought to do is stand behind the Sixth Amendment and say you're not going to create these secret lists where people are put on it without their knowledge, where they're not given an opportunity to defend themselves in a public and speedy trial. That's what the Constitution says, right? Have a jury trial of their peers, be afforded a lawyer if they can't afford one. All these things are in the Sixth Amendment. They don't care about that. The no-fly list is already punishment assigned to people who have merely been accused in absentia, secretly by a star chamber process of being bad guys. That's all I have to do. So they don't want to stand up for real civil rights, okay? And the true irony of it is, if you look at the picture of this guy, John Lewis, okay, as Dermot Breen and Leanne McAdoo are pointing out, this is a guy who's been on the no-fly list multiple times himself, along with Ted Kennedy. Okay? He should know better than this. As a matter of fact, he's been on civil rights. He's been on a watch list himself because he was a civil rights activist, just like Martin Luther King was on a watch list himself. They don't care about that because now he's part of the power establishment, isn't he? Now John Lewis is part of the establishment. So now what he demands is that other people be put on watch lists. And not only that, other people be punished. He wasn't punished for being on a watch list, okay? But he wants to enact punishments. He wants to say, well, we put you on a list and label you as such, then, you know, you're going to have to, you're not going to be able to travel. And that no-fly list, as I pointed out, it's going to be a no-drive list. It's going to be a no-walk list, house arrest. All right. That's how our rights disappear. Why do you think they use the words infringement in the Second Amendment? Because they're not going to take them all at once. It is soft tyranny. It is soft martial law. They're moving the fence gradually onto your property and leaving it there. And then saying, well, you didn't do anything about that infringement around the edge, so now that property belongs to me. So your rights are property. And so they're saying, oh, that property now belongs to me. All right? So this guy, John Lewis, is now the face of the surveillance state. He's now the face of the police state. He used to be the target of the police state back in the day. Then he sold out when he became the establishment. And we got Paul Ryan, who can't do anything because he's a busted chair. Now, I want to play for you one of the House Democrats, Charlie Rangel, who comes in and is confronted by the Daily Caller's Carrie Pickett. And she asked him some great questions, and he gave her some very candid answers about the right of people to keep guns. She asked him about, Well, shouldn't ordinary law-abiding citizens have guns? Oh, no. But you have guns to protect yourself. Oh, that's different. We need guns to protect us. Okay, let's play that clip.
But overall, if it's difficult to get a concealed weapon permit, I'm glad to hear that.
But why is it that only the
well, that's corruption.
Celebrities and like, and then the people in your district, a number of them who are law-abiding citizens, many of them who would want to carry a concealed carry permit.
I wouldn't want them to have it. I know what you're trying to say.
But
corruption is corruption. It's bad.
Okay, but like, let's talk about that for a second. Why should say the uber wealthy who have protection had that protection, but individuals who are law-abiding citizens in your district should not? Let's talk about that.
Well, law-abiding citizens just shouldn't have to carry a gun. You know that. So you're not going to push me in that direction.
But you're protected by guns all over the place here in the Capitol.
Well, that's a little different. I think we need to be protected down here.
Oh, they need to be protected, but law-abiding citizens don't. You know, I don't think law-abiding citizens should have a gun carry permit. No, but we need to have an army protecting us. Let's look at Uber. Uber, you know, they're ahead of the game here. They've enacted their own gun control. And they did it after a shooting. Good for them. Oh, but wait a minute. This was a shooting where a gun was used to save lives. They used a gun to save lives, okay? This comes 3 months after an Uber driver with a concealed carry license thwarted an attempt at a mass shooting by pulling his own weapon and shooting a gunman who had opened fire in Chicago's Logan Square. And, of course, this is an individual who has all the permits in a place like Chicago, where it's nearly impossible to do it. As they were saying to him, it's virtually impossible unless you were the uber rich in New York to get a carry permit. And he goes, oh, well, you're talking about a situation of corruption. It's like, And it's corruption when Rangel has protection and you don't too. Okay, that's also corruption. It's also a violation of our rights. But the Chicago Tribune reported the driver was watching a group of people walk in front of his car on North Milwaukee Avenue just before midnight when a 22-year-old just began firing into a crowd. So he pulled over, pulled his gun out, shot the guy 3 times, shin, thigh, lower back, stopped the shooting. Now, Uber says, we're going to ban guns. This is in a city that recorded the 300th homicide this last weekend, 13 over Father's Day weekend alone. A no-gun zone, Chicago. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. We're just talking about the House whiners who took over the process in the House of Representatives, and we had Paul Ryano unwilling or unable to shut that down. Of course, they've stopped that now. But Leanne McAdoo gave this to our producer, who ran in here and said, hey, here's a letter from just 2 years ago. Signed by a lot of these Zimbocrats, okay, especially John Lewis, who's become the spokesperson for this, saying, sent this to Homeland Security and said, watch lists are an important tool to guard against terrorism, but they must strike the right balance with U.S. civil rights and liberties. Innocent Americans who are placed on the watch list, there has to be a method for them to have redress for this. Yeah, you know what? It's called the Sixth Amendment. And so they wrote this letter of concern, and if you got that document, Cam, there, you can see John Lewis's signature right there as part of that document right there, okay? Yet now they're not concerned about that. And you know what? Nothing has changed, except it's gotten worse, okay? And now they want to use that to apply punishments to people who are on the list when they know that innocent people are being put on that list. And also in the news today, we have users claiming that Google, this is via Drudge Report on Daily Caller, users are claiming that Google is putting Trump emails in their spam box. These are people who use Gmail. And they say, hey, all these Trump campaign things are being automatically put in spam, even though I didn't want it that way. And, of course, there's been previous reports by Julian Assange, they point out, WikiLeaks, saying Google is directly engaged with the Hillary Clinton campaign. We've seen evidence of this. We know that former CEO of Google, Eric Schmidt, last year started an organization called The Groundwork, with the intention of getting Hillary Clinton elected. And, of course, there's been more than 400 visits to the White House, to the Obama White House, by the Google people. So, yeah, they're going to censor that. You know, one way that you can get the message out, that you can get out there and get this information out, we talked about this yesterday, Slate was absolutely apoplectic about the fact that there was a professional poker player, 27-year-old lady who was also on the latest season of Survivor, and she was in Vegas wearing a Hillary for Prison t-shirt, our t-shirt. And they even say she got it at InfoWars. Oh, these people are paranoid. Well, you know, she's informed. As a matter of fact, she voted for Obama in 2008, she said, but, you know, she understood what he's done. She's not happy with what he did, and she sees Hillary Clinton as a corrupt criminal. And she is. And if you want other people to understand that you want to put her in the big house and not in the White House, get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt. We have an incredible discount going on right now on those t-shirts. Right now, you can get your first one for 50% off. And if you sign up for our newsletter, you can get the second one for 75% off. So that's an incredible discount off of already very competitive priced t-shirts. Take a look at that. It's a great design. Very, very popular. You'll see them all over the place. And it's a, let's say, a conversation starter, especially with the mainstream media. We've also got some news here on Brexit. A lot of people are wondering, when are we going to get some results? Well, we're not going to have any exit polls there, interestingly enough. This is an article that appeared yesterday where they were talking about. They said, you know, unlike normal general elections, there won't be any exit polls at 10 p.m. London time or 5 p.m. Eastern time when the voting stations close. That's because none of the British broadcasters have commissioned any exit polls because of concerns over accuracy. That's according to the Telegraph. Concerns over accuracy. Now, would that be concerns over the accuracy of the exit polls? No, I don't think so. I think that'd be concern over the accuracy of the reported results, don't you think? Because you see, as I put in that that 1 minute liner that we've been playing today, one of the ways that easiest ways, most direct ways to understand if there's voter fraud is to actually ask the people who showed up at the polls and voted as they're walking out of the poll. Who did you vote for? And we have that in the United States in our elections. It's run by one organization. They do it as a pool for all of the mainstream media. They do it for all the cable companies, Fox, CNN, others, AP, UPI, you know, all these. Well, I don't think UPI is around anymore, but they do it for AP. They do it for CBS, NBC, ABC, CBS, NBC. But you never see the results in America. Our State Department, when it looks at the results from foreign countries' exit polls, they look at it and they say, hey, if this is more than 2%, we suspect fraud. We have situations here where Hillary was running against Bernie in the primaries. We've got 11 states where Hillary got between 5 and 10% more in the reported results than she did out of the exit polls. And so there's an organization, as I've reported before, that is putting together a possible racketeering lawsuit against that. They're waiting to get the information out of California about that. We've seen this happen before in Brazil. In Brazil, the woman who is, they're now trying, have been trying to impeach, and I haven't kept up with that. I don't know what happened with that. But I know that when she ran in 2014, she was behind 9.6% in the polls, then won. Electronic voting machines and no exit polls. That's the way they do it, folks. When we come back, we're going to have Alex Jones joining us.
The Empire.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm your host, Alex Jones. I'm about to throw to a very important video report that's posted at InfoWars.com by John Bowne. That really boils my blood. Now, I get Google alerts sent to my so-called smartphone when InfoWars.com or the words Alex Jones are basically in a major news story. And so I get hundreds, if not thousands, of different links sent to me a day. Sometimes there are thousands of articles a day that have InfoWars.com or the words Alex Jones in it. Not to mention Prison Planet or Paul Watson or Joe Biggs or Jakari Jackson or Leanne Mack, or the list goes on and on. And I'm not bragging about that. I'm simply pointing out to listeners, InfoWars is having a huge effect. Now, let's talk about though, where InfoWars.com or Alex Jones are being discussed. I'm not talking about a Google alert when just someone says my name on the web. That'd be hundreds of thousands or millions of times a day. I'm talking about Google News aggregate that is of so-called establishment news sites. We're talking thousands of links a day, some days, always hundreds. And it is vicious attacks. It is disinformation. It is outright lies. It is total fabrication. And some people would say, Alex, we really feel sorry for you. Isn't that terrible? I want to tell the listeners, this is wonderful, fabulous, fantastic news. To be targeted like this, to have them try to assassinate my name and my crew's name and InfoWars' name shows we are over the target. To use the old World War II analogy that we use so much because it's so perfect, they didn't really have, you know, good ways of detecting, especially in cloudy weather, where the cities were or the bases or the factories they were bombing. But they would steer towards the flak or the anti-aircraft shells that were bursting in the air and then sending out ribbons of steel. They would fly basically into those clouds because they knew that directly below it was the main targets they were hitting. If one B-17 could get a few bombs into, say, a Panzer tank factory, that could save tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of lives. So those pilots were there risking themselves. Well, all I'm risking is my name and a bunch of zombies that still read mainstream news. And most of the people that read mainstream news aren't even zombies. I mean, I harp on this because it's so important. We're talking about, again, a 6% approval rating in a national poll the Associated Press did. 6% of people trust mainstream media. 6%. Now, again, I know I harp on that every day. Just think about that. This is a discredited group of trash. Now, with that said, though, boy, yesterday and today, I got over 100 links sent to me out of New York Daily News, out of Idaho Statesman, out of Twin Falls Times, out of Salon, out of the Daily Beast, you know, all the so-called liberal publications with headlines like this. Story of Syrian refugees raping Idaho girl is false. Or they've got other ones saying, you know, right-wing conspiracy sites push story, false story about Syrian refugees raping girl. You can go see these for yourself. Of course, Snopes, run by one lady and her cat, you know, is the authority and weighs in and says none of it's true. It didn't happen. And when you go read the articles, it's incredible. They go, oh, you got caught in disinformation. This all just came from the internet, places like InfoWars.com and message boards. And they weren't Syrian refugees. No, they were from other Middle Eastern countries. Well, we know that. That's our whole point. Most of the so-called Syrian refugees are invaders that went into Syria with ISIS and Al-Qaeda, got their butts kicked, and then came through Europe and then to the United States. So, A, Syrian refugee is just a term for Muslims from Africa and the Middle East and Asia, Central Asia being brought in. Okay, that's, so we're not discredited there. We link to local news reports, TV and print, with the people at city council saying you covered up this rape. Then they go on to say, well, we've arrested these youth, but they didn't rape her. They touched her, but we're just going to stop there. So they're judge, jury, and executioner, and the whole case is sealed. So, A, the story's not a hoax, even according to police. People were arrested. And the town is saying there's a cover-up. Then they go on to say, oh, the right-wingers always claim that refugees rape people. All over Europe, from Sweden to Germany to France to Spain to Portugal to Greece to Italy, they cover up the refugees and the crime waves and the mass rapings until it gets so bad that refugees are running around pooping on the street, pooping in pools, shooting guns in the air that are illegal, running around grabbing and raping hundreds of women at a time. The German mayors say, come out and say, you know, don't wear short mini skirts, or we've got to ban Oktoberfest or have it behind closed doors because it makes the Muslims angry. On and on and on. I mean, the first time it was fake? No, it wasn't. The second time, was it a fake story? No, it wasn't. The 500th time, was it a fake story? No. The 10,000th time? It's over 10,000 reported rapes the last year by Islamicists in France alone. It got to the point now where France, Sweden, and Germany are ordering police not to put where the person's from. And then they just say that a Frenchman raped, or they say a German raped. You know, this guy, this Muslim that stabbed two police officers last week in France, he wasn't even from France, but they put him up on TV and said, the Frenchman was from North Africa. The Frenchman was from Pluto. The Frenchman was from Mars. The Frenchman was from Toledo, Ohio. The Frenchman was from Japan. Anywhere but France. So on and on and on. This is the culture. Any unattended woman can be raped. This is what goes on in these countries. These countries are the most backward scum holes you can imagine, where in Saudi Arabia, if a woman gets raped, they execute her. It's her fault she got raped. They throw acid on women's faces, all this. And then they sit there with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of articles with my name in it and InfoWars' name saying, I'm a liar, when we didn't even discover the story. We reported it like 15th hand after it had been in three TV stations and two newspapers at least that we sourced in our article that was mainstream. Our headline said that people were protesting at the city council alleging a cover-up of an alleged rape. So A, we didn't say that there had been a rape. We went with their headline, there had been an alleged rape, and there was a big controversy about it. And then Drudge Report picked up our journalistic story that broke down what people were saying. Now, I don't know whether the little girl was raped or not, or whether she was urinated on. I don't know that. But that's exactly what people from the very same countries have been caught doing all over Europe, and we have thousands of videos of them carjacking people, hundreds of videos of them mass raping and groping and going insane and crazy. And then you sit there and use your magic word, because you're such big intellectuals, and say that I'm a conspiracy theorist and that none of this exists. So, am I worried about these type of attacks? No. Because the 6% that read these publications and believe it are brain dead, Stockholm Syndrome victims who don't know what planet they're living on. I will continue to tell the truth. I will continue to seek out the truth. I will continue to take action against tyrants. I will continue to never back down. And I know our supporters are taking action as well. You can try to censor the internet. You can try to lie about us. You can try to do whatever you want. We're going to move forward, and we're going to expose your new world order. More of Paul Watson coming up, more of David Knight and others co-hosting while I'm on the road. But first, this powerful John Bound report recapping what I just broke down. But you can go read these articles and see how they are the anatomies of deception. They are the very tissue of lies. I mean, just so many other lies I didn't get to. Okay? Implying we said it was a rape. We reported on the controversy. Implying we were wrong about where the refugees are from. No, we document this is the cover for the total invasion. And then implying, and the bigger angle is they're authorizing a mosque to be built for them and not authorizing locals even do repairs on their houses. They roll out the red carpet for these people. We need to have a serious discussion about the real numbers of these folks being brought in. It's probably 100 times what we're being told conservatively. All right, here is John Bound's powerful report, and then back to the live crew in Austin, Texas, London, England, and more.
Three Syrian refugees reportedly raped a little girl at knife point in Idaho before urinating on her body, an incident that prompted furious residents to accuse Twin Falls City Council members of covering up the assault. The sexual assault allegedly took place on June 2nd, but has received virtually no media attention aside from one vague KMVT report. However, residents have been circulating what really happened on social media, with the Creeping Sharia blog reporting that the victim was a young girl who was born premature and is less developed for her age. The victim's grandmother found the victim and then called the girl's mother, who called the police. The police took 2.5 hours to arrive, but were unable to take any action due to the language barrier. When she arrived, the mother of the alleged rapist was only able to say, "No police," while the father reportedly congratulated his 13-year-old son. Video of the entire assault was captured on the boy's cell phone. But according to the Idaho Statesman, the Twin Falls County prosecutor, Grant Loeb, says there were no Syrians involved, there was no knife involved, and there was no gang rape. Loeb continued, "There is a small group of people in Twin Falls County whose life goal is to eliminate refugees, and thus far they have not been constrained by the truth. They have not been constrained by the truth in the past, and I don't expect them to be constrained by the truth in the future." Truth. These supposed city leaders would have the good people of Twin Falls believe there isn't any invasion of psychotic refugees gradually flooding the United States that will soon resemble the horror transpiring in Europe. Just listen to your elected leaders. They know best, right? Well,
so the first item is general public input. If there is anyone here from the public who wishes to address the council on an issue that is not on tonight's agenda, now is your chance to please come forward.
We've been made aware of a situation, an alleged assault of a minor child And we can't get any information on it. Apparently, it's been indicated that it was the perpetrators were four Muslim youth that conducted this, I guess it was rape, and we've heard that it's consensual, but my concern is there's no such thing as consensual rape of a minor.
I am telling you, I am not aware of a news story about allegations of an assault against a minor in our community by Islamists.
Idaho's First News has confirmed that a reported sexual assault around the Fondbrook Apartments in Twin Falls is being investigated by the Twin Falls Police Department. The incident allegedly occurred on June 2nd. Twin Falls County Prosecutor Grant Lopes has confirmed the investigation, but says there will be no charges filed in the case until the investigation is complete. Unconfirmed reports concerning the case are circulating on social media, but no one will comment officially on the case while it is still under investigation.
Where is the national media on this story? The only outrage is actually from the politically correct downplaying the crime, as Snopes.com has labeled the information circulating on the web as mostly false. And it appears Loeb actually was right, technically. The miners accused of the assault weren't Syrian. They were from Sudan and Iraq, and the rest of the details are hidden from public view because miners committed the heinous act. Loeb's BS is correct. But rather than protect America's children by getting to the bottom of it and calming any fears brewing within the local community, the Twin Falls City Council would have anyone concerned branded a bigot and a white supremacist. The council was also grilled as to how a mosque was approved after just 24 hours, whereas a new home application would take at least 2 weeks just to process. Just another blatant example of what may be coming to, or without you even knowing, is currently happening in your community.
You might look at us and think that we're some kind of a coalition of weirdos, and actually, there's professionals, there's business owners, there's college graduates. We're not just a bunch of weird people. We're people that are living here in this community, paying our taxes, or nationals of somewhere in the United States or Idaho. And we have what we feel, anyway, are legitimate concerns.
Due to mounting pressure from the Twin Falls community, the families of the boys accused of the assault have since been evicted. John Bound for Infowars.com.
That's a great report from our reporter, John Bound, putting together people's concerns because we're not seeing any vetting or background checks of the people we're bringing into this country, are we? And of course, anytime they commit crimes, it's covered up and we're told, as he pointed out in the report, oh, it's an American who did this or a Frenchman who did this. Well, they're second generation. And as we've talked about that, the second generation is far more dangerous as a group than the first generation. When they're brought in here, the first generation understands something about where they came from. But the second generation has been fed this diet of hate in the schools. And they're looking to create a second identity. And in the cases of these Muslim communities, they've also been self-ghettoized, where they're not really getting out in the other crowd. They don't mix with other people. So all these factors come together and create this situation. Now, before we go back to Brexit, I just want to point out some of the specials we've got today. We've got the Tim Kennedy special still going, 15% off of Super Male Vitality, Brain Force, and Secret 12. You'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, all of our Alexa Pure water filters, from the largest system down to the shower filter, are still 20% off at InfoWarsStore.com. And then we have Hillary for Prison at InfoWarsStore.com. We have the Hillary for Prison t-shirt. You can get 50% off the Hillary for Prison t-shirt. When you go there, you'll see a link to sign up for the newsletter. If you sign up for the newsletter and you're a new newsletter recipient, you get a code and you can get a second t-shirt or more for 75% off. This is a great way to spread the message as to which house Hillary needs to be sent to, okay? And that's the big house. Now, we're not going to have any results for the Brexit vote, interestingly enough, for quite some time. And as I pointed out before, that's because they have chosen not to do any exit polls. I mean, don't you really find that suspicious? The news organization says, no, on this big event, right, the biggest event these people are going to vote on in their lives, we don't really want to have the results for you right away. We want these to trickle in gradually and slowly overnight. where they can manage the results and manage expectations. And as I point out, having no exit polls is the first sign of massive rigging of elections. Now, take a look at this article that we have at Infowars.com. Brexit Insider says the European Union is the new Soviet Union. And, of course, this is taken from my interview yesterday with Lord Christopher Monckton. Take a look at the article. Take a look at the interview. He had a lot to say. But let me read you a couple of excerpts from what he had to say yesterday. He said the European Constitution is an entirely anti-democratic constitution. In fact, it's very much like the Soviet Constitution on which it was modeled. All that has happened is the Soviet Constitution has moved westward, and we are now effectively the European Supreme Soviet. He said, don't be fooled by all the economic arguments that the Treasury has simply made up numbers to try to say we would go bankrupt if we were out of the European Union. We'll go bankrupt for sure if we're in it. In the last two decades, the stock market in London has had its worst two decades in 650 years of operation. That's how well the EU has done for us. And finally, he says, imagine if you were in the United States and you were told that you had to depend on 27 other nations, on their will, any of whom could say no to anything you did. That's what we have in Europe. He said we have a dictatorship. So will today be Independence Day for Britain? Not sure. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show for our final segment. I'm David Knight. As we were saying, as we went to break, we have an article on Infowars.com. Brexit Insider says EU is the new Soviet Union. It truly is about sovereignty. They talk a lot about economics. And, of course, the Leave people have some very specific metrics that they've taken, saying, look at how much more we're sending each week to the European Union that we're losing, a net loss of 350 million pounds. That's about $500,000 a week they're sending. Said, we could use this however we wish here. We could put it into the national health system that they have there, the welfare system or whatever. But that's going to other people who write our laws, who write 60% of our laws. You can't have prosperity when you lose your sovereignty. And there was an interesting article that came out this last weekend from the Washington Post. I say Europe worries that a Brexit vote could trigger a stampede of exits. And I thought this opening paragraph was very interesting. They said, the decision could lead to the destruction of one of the most ambitious political projects since the Holy Roman Empire. And what we see now happening is truly part of the world government plan. We've been saying that for a very long time. It is an ambitious political process to remove sovereignty from all of the Western governments who really oppose these neo-colonialists. We're the only ones that had the power and the wealth to oppose the globalists. And so they're shutting down our governments. They're going to have their way in the third world, just as they always have. But now they're treating us as if we were their colonies, and they're shutting down our governments. And the Washington Post is talking about this. They say, among the casualties, critics fear could be plans for a massive free trade deal between the United States and Europe. They say, the days, if they get out of this agreement, they say the days in which leaders convened in Brussels to hand over even more sovereignty to the European Union may be over if Britain departs, say diplomats. You see, that's the problem. That's what's destroying Britain as well as the other countries. They're handing over, they're meeting in Brussels to hand over the sovereignty to this foreign body. And that is not going to stop if they remain, okay? They say, well, it might stop if we remain. And they have a quote from a guy who says, we have a flag, we have an anthem. We don't have much of what supports that flag and that anthem, said the chief of staff to Jacques Delors, the leader of the European Commission, from 1985 to 1995. He was considered to be one of the main architects of the modern EU. So they got a flag, they got an anthem, but they don't have the things to support this United States of Europe, which is now being consolidated with America, with the transatlantic partnership. That's the next step. They don't want it to unravel before they go to the next step of consolidation. And they go on to say, this is Washington Post openly talking about how this how they're consolidating this and taking away people's sovereignty. They say the turmoil is, quote, extremely disappointing to the founding fathers who thought they were like medieval alchemists, he said. They thought they could transform the stone of economic integration into the gold of political integration. Understand that. They're going to take this stone and turn it into gold, okay? What is the stone? Economic integration. They want to turn that into political integration. And that's what we're telling you. the Trans-Pacific and the Transatlantic Party partnerships are not about free trade. They're about taking you over politically. We have the EFF, the Electronic Freedom Foundation, others saying, hey, this is not about trade. This is about taking our rights on the internet and other things. And it is far more than that, folks. It is global governance. We're going to have our Independence Day vote, referendum, first Tuesday in November. It's going to be about Trump. You know, Trump said yesterday, we got here because we switched from a policy of Americanism to a policy of globalism. So stay with us and join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the InfoWars Nightly News.